All right, we are now live. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the 13th session of Caldera. This one is part three of On the Lamb and For the Slaughter. We've been playing for almost a year now. I just realized that the other day with the Brigade Con around the corner at the end of the month here. When we started this game, the first game that we played was for Brigade Con 2015. So, yeah, be looking for that in the future. So before we get started, do a small brief recap. The posse had ridden on the train between Wayward Gallows and Mournful Valley and ran into a little bit of, not resistance, but just a small little instance on the train with some of the soldiers from the Army of the Integrated Realms that were on board and were shooting buffalo in mass from the train. And there was a little bit of a slight heated exchange between the party and these soldiers, but all in all, it went just fine. And they managed to arrive in Mournful Valley with a little other problem. So they were seeking a mage rite, a dwarven mage rite, who they were told practiced in secret in the town of Mournful Valley. And he goes by the name of Ogden Kell. One of the things that they pointed out about him was that he had one arm. So you guys met with him and talked it over a little bit and switched some things, some magic item enchantments over from a couple of items. I believe we had four of them total. There were the magic missile wand for Padre Estevez was getting worked into his shotgun, the Holy Ghost. Eagle Witness was having the belt, the dwarven belt, put into his chaps, which are going to be assless, by the way. His bullets were being put into his dwarf bone breastplate. And then Daryl, who was not represented this evening, but he was having the bushwhacker rifle that used to be wielded by Varian put into his pistol.
And my shards of stained glass were being changed into the firing mechanism of my shotgun.
Oh, that's right. I forgot to write that down. Thank you. I forgot that we'd taken care of that afterwards. So, yes. And I think we stopped right about the time that you guys had made all of your deals with, the mage rite, and, we're going to have downtime for a couple of days in the town of Mournful Valley, which I think you guys pretty much settled up at the end of last session. So before we get too much further into what's going on, just go over a couple of things. Obviously with the comment that I made, this is an adult game. If you didn't already run away, now's a good chance to do that. This game is based loosely in spirit, at least, off of a graphic novel called The Sixth Gun. I highly recommend it. It's very cool. And if you're into this kind of weird West, this Western meets fantasy type thing, it very much is... up that same alley. I would highly recommend you check it out. let me see what else. Oh, there is another game that I play in online that is run by our very own Eli Kurtz down there at the bottom. Derek Smith and Alex Baldwin are also players in it. The link to his game is down in the description of this video. Check it out. There's definitely some good stuff on there. I think we just went into like our 11th, 10th, something like that session.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Yeah. So it's been going for a little while. It's a lot of fun. It's a Savage Worlds game. So yeah, go check it out. Give it some love. Yeah, I don't think that there's anything else that I've missed, unless you guys can think of anything before we get into introductions and then get started. No? Cool. All right, then. We'll go ahead and we'll start with introductions, and we'll start with Alex.
Hi, I am Alex. I'm playing Brother Cutter. He is a slightly insane, knowledge-obsessed guy. And he is known as the Swiss Army Prophet because he is a prophet and he's good at everything, kind of.
Excellent. And Brian.
I am Brian. I am playing James, Travis, Lee, Luke, Joe, Jane. He is a fighter, formerly soldier scout. And is somewhat new to the party, and kind of dodging the law a little bit. Totally not his fault. Complete and total misunderstanding. But we've gotten it taken care of now.
Okay, and Derek?
I am Derek. I am playing Padre Estevez, the devout cleric of Luz, on a mission to bring the word of the Lord to the people of the Caldera and to try to keep this rowdy bunch in line. It's not always working, though.
It's very true. I was going to say good luck with that. We've got Eli.
Hello, everyone. I'm Eli. I'm playing Eagle Witness, who is a Durathian brave. He was a bard mostly, and just recently he became a little bit more combative. He has a spirit animal, the eagle, who always flies on the horizon and who guides his actions and judges them. And that's about it.
And Mad Dog, last but not least.
So my name is Michael. I play Dree Tannen. He goes by Mad Dog. He is a halfling smuggler. He's a little bit off in the head. He makes some pretty bad decisions sometimes. Some great decisions, actually. His favorite weapon is dynamite. And he has become a smuggler to get some coin. His current mission at the moment is to get enough money to go back to his love, Miss Jubilee High Horse. So he's looking to find her again.
Excellent. Okay. Switch my camera off right now because I'm having bandwidth issues or something. Okay. So I think we're ready to get started, unless you guys can think of anything else to add. All right. Let's rock and or roll. Okay. So you have been in Mournful Valley for a few days. I'm going on 4 days now, waiting for your augmented gear that you have let this mage rite work on for you. And you've been checking in with him. A couple of you have been actually studying in his locale. Some of you have been assisting him, and he's gotten a couple of the items finished, returned to you. They were worth every gold piece, even though they were worth quite a bit of gold pieces. And you are very happy with the results thus far. And as a matter of fact, that's where we're joining the characters currently, is whoever is the last one to get their item returned to them is currently talking with Ogden Kell. it is later in the evening so that the rest of the employees of the acquisitions warehouse are gone for the day, so that there are no prying eyes or ears as this transaction is completing. Who wants to be the person who's getting their item last here?
I can. No one else wants to.
All right, him.
I would have to be getting an item to be able to volunteer.
All right, so Padre, you are getting your shotgun back.
That's correct. The Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost. So you are down inside of Ogden's little magical, strange place that's underground. If you remember the description, you had to take an elevator down some stories and pass through a large set of ancient Durathian wooden doors. So you are underground with him, and he is, you know, just pulled back the cloth on your shotgun. He says, "Well, there you go. That ought to do it."
I pick it up, inspect it. And as I do that, I put the ring of silence that I have back on the barrel.
Mm-hmm.
And say, do you have somewhere I can try this out?
Well, sure, yeah. Just over there in the corner there. Shoot away from that barrel particularly.
Of course, my son. So then I'll load it up and try it out.
Okay. Yeah, it's a little bit lighter than it was before. You're guessing because some of the action has been removed and replaced with the stained glass from the broken shards that you carried with you. So it is a little bit lighter, and it's a little more colorful. There's kind of a rainbow glass. It looks effectively like the action of the shotgun is now made of stained glass.
Cool.
So you load a shell in. You kind of stand off to the side. And he puts his fingers in his ears and chills for a little bit. Kind of gives you a nod.
Well, I will shoot it and kind of chuckle when he puts his fingers in his ears.
Okay. All right. So, yeah, you blast away. It is extremely loud since you're underground in this stone chamber.
Ooh, but I have the ring of silence on it.
Oh, you do. Beautiful. That's right. So it is not loud at all. Quite the opposite, even. You might even say silent. And, yeah, out from the end comes this kind of purplish, almost in the vein of magic missile, colored energy, this cone of just magical explosion erupts from the end. And it covers the same area that it would before with a normal shell. But it all looks to be magical energy instead of pellets.
Well, after it shoots, I will kind of blink because it was kind of dark, and then all these bright lights went off when it shot, so I had to clear my eyes a little bit, and I will turn to, I forget his name. What's his name?
Ogden.
I'll turn to Ogden and think, thank you, my son. It is quite good.
Good, good. That's a pretty nifty ring you got there, too.
Well, thank you. And I will put the Holy Ghost away and turn to my companions and say, shall we?
He says, I appreciate the business. And he kind of grips your hand tight, you know, as he's shaking it. Probably a little bit harder than he needs to. And he kind of makes sure you make eye contact with him. And he says, more than your patronage, I appreciate your discretion.
Luz is the only one that shall know the secret.
Good to hear, Padre. Good to hear. He kind of slaps you on the arm and then lets you go. Okay, so you return to the surface, to the town itself, and you see something on the horizon to the west that may give you some reason for concern. It's a very, very large looming Stormhead, Thunderhead, what have you, Stormfront. And it looks, hopefully I can still do screen share with my camera turned off. I don't see why I shouldn't. Bear with me as my computer muddles its way through this. Hopefully you guys can see, maybe.
I see down at the bottom is a graphic that says you're screen sharing, but I don't see anything on the screen.
Huh.
Hello.
Present to everyone?
Yeah, it says you're presenting to everyone, but it's still screen.
Maybe I have to turn my camera on. Let's see here. Is it doing it now? No, doesn't look like it.
No, we didn't give a camera feedback either. But
not a thing.
All right, hang on.
Camera feed's back now.
This is not what the storm looks like.
Oh, darn it.
It's horrible!
It's
all a thunderhead, though.
It's true. I think it's just a blackhead, but let's hope. Okay, maybe that works?
That worked, yep.
Yeah, all right.
There you go.
So, yeah, it looks like that. It's a very, very massive storm front, and it kind of does this funneling towards the center of it, but then it's just, like, truncated on the bottom, or it's almost like an upside-down tree trunk, and it's just, like, hovering over the land. And even at night, you're not having difficulty seeing it because there is lightning that accompanies it. Let me see if I can... Hopefully that changed with it. Yeah. Ignore the boats and the city lights and stuff, but kind of like that, where it's just this almost constant lightning tearing down from that center column of this storm. And when it does so, it lights up the entire body of the cloud. And those of you who are looking actually notice that within the cloud, the upper part, you think you see like enormous silhouetted figures inside, moving about. And it sounds like, or it appears as though, here's another picture. It appears as though those of you with spirit animals, that their attention is also drawn to this storm. In fact, they seem almost fixated on it.
The witness is waiting outside the warehouse whenever you guys arrive, and pretty much as soon as it happens, he points and he says, "Behold, the eagle has turned its eye to the storm."
Yeah, hell no. It's whiskey time.
Hmm.
This weather does seem to be blocking Luz's light from reaching us.
Is it coming over here?
It does not seem to be moving at the... Well, I mean, it is moving, but it seems to be spinning in place.
I'm asking Eagle Witness. He's been watching it.
Oh, I see.
It does not seem to be moving. It seems to be spinning in place, but not getting any closer or further.
That was awesome, Eli.
You take a point of inspiration, you bastard.
All right.
Are there any other townspeople watching it?
Yes. There's not a whole lot of townspeople out and about at this time of night. But those that are absolutely paying attention. one of them is apparently drunk, and he keeps like blinking his eyes and then like widening them forcibly, like over and over again, trying to rubbing at the corners of them and then trying again, trying to see if he's actually seeing this or not. He turns to whichever one of you is closest. He's, you guys see the cloudy thingy?
No, you're crazy. Go away.
Only one of them.
Oh. Okay, well, I've been drinking a little bit. I'm gonna lay down right here. If it starts to rain, you wake me up, okay?
I'll talk to him. I'll say, my son, I might suggest you move inside.
Okay. You're a smart man. And he kind of stumbles off in some nondescript direction.
When he leaves, Eagle Witness looks at everyone and says, he is a liar. He has been drinking a lot of it.
I'll tell Eagle Witness, Luz forgives these little lies.
I cast Druidcraft to see if it's going to rain nearby.
Does that like predict when, or is it just like within a relatively short window after this?
It's 24 hours.
Okay, so within the next 24 hours? Yes.
All right, I say, well, it's going to be here within the next day, though, because it's common.
How many of these figures are there?
None of them look consistent. Like four? It's not like you see one thing and can identify it as a, you know, like a shark. And then you're like, oh, there's that shark again. You know, oh, look, it's a Sharknado. It's, you know, it's like you might see a shark, but then you also see, you know, a person or, you know, a winged beast. It's kind of just constantly changing.
I'm going to assume it's the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And I'm going to get that drunk guy, and I'm going to tell him that he needs to warn everybody.
We already killed the four horsemen of the apocalypse.
He says, oh, no, you're right. The halfling is protected. The end is nigh. The halfling, the half the world's going to end. He starts just running off, like screaming into the night, knocking on people's doors. Okay, so yeah, you've got this this Fantasia ship brewing on the horizon to the west.
Would we know which way, like, weather usually comes in this town?
Next on.
What was that?
I've noticed that the eagle is transfixed on this storm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I don't have any way that I know of, maybe like a wisdom check or something, to commune with my spirit guide and find out if like there's some sort of like if I should go check it out. I want to commune with my spirit guide. I'm just not sure how to do it.
Animal handling.
Ooh. Yeah, I don't have it.
Oh, guess who has it? I do.
Well then commune with your own spirit guide.
Great. I look at Seshat and I say, Seshat, what is so interesting about the storm besides, you know, that it's beautiful and probably sent here by Luz to smite infidels?
I don't think that your spirit animal can talk, is that correct?
My spirit animal is also my familiar.
Ah, well then in that case, yes, it can. It says, well, there's something about it. It draws my attention.
My spirit animal is French.
Okay. Well, there is something about it. It just draws my attention in. I cannot tell what it is. I think it has, what is the word? Attraction.
I say, well, do you want to go investigate it?
Of course I do.
I'm a
silly man.
I throw my arm out to help him go fly over and investigate it.
Are you going to follow, or is it just me? A wee little owl.
I cannot fly. You know that. I've tried.
Get on your horsey and follow me.
Okay. Wait, actually, I can't fly.
Really, you're also a Rastafarian.
And I follow him.
Okay.
Also, I tell Eagle Witness, come on.
Ah, yes. Others,
and I say, also you guys, come on.
I whistle and my horse arrives, and I get on my horse.
So Brother Cutter tells all of you that his familiar has told him that he must ride out of town in the middle of the night.
No, I didn't say any of that. I just said, come on.
Fair enough.
That they don't speak owl.
Yeah, but everything that you thought was inside your head was actually out loud.
That's very possible.
He's actually just mimicking it with his hand in like the sock puppet format.
And you were actually also talking for your owl. It was very confusing.
Yeah. Is there like a standard way for people to interact with their spirit animals, or is it kind of unique to each person?
It would be pretty unique, but the reason that he has such the kind of connection that he does is because it's all his familiar as his wizard? I think it's wizard.
Warlock.
There you go.
Gotcha.
So that's the reason why he's actually able to talk to it and interact with it that way.
Gotcha. So I can see his owl then, and I can see him speaking to his owl.
I think some of the time you can, because the familiar doesn't always exist on the material plane.
Gotcha.
But he does right now.
Okay, so then yes.
Well, yeah, it would have to for him to talk to it.
Yeah, then I think I would instantly understand what's going on, and I wouldn't hesitate to follow him out there.
Okay, excellent.
But I would ask, what did your spirit guide tell you?
We must investigate it closer to see what it is, but there's a magical attraction that will bring the spirit animals over there.
I look off to the horizon and I say, yes, the eagle flies toward it. Let us go.
All right, so Brother Cutter and Eagle Witness are climbing up on their horses.
Are horses right there?
I imagine they went to where they were, the stable.
I whistle for my horse.
Oh, yeah. There you go. That's right.
Yeah, we just whistle when they come.
Eagle Witness has a free-range horse. I will go to where my horse is. And I guess saddle it up.
All right.
Considering I can speak with animals, I let my horse free-range too.
Excellent. Okay. Is there anybody that is not going? I know that at least Joe had expressed interest in having other plans. All right. Is it Joe this week or no?
It's Jane this week.
Jane?
Yep, Jane.
All right, then. A man named Jane.
A very bad wig.
Oh, good Lord.
Mad Dog wants to go investigate.
And a coconut bra? Okay. So Mad Dog is going to go with?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and once the rest of the group is all going, I'll throw my hands up in the air. Fine.
Before the Padre heads out of town, though, he'll stop by the church and warn the local clergy to batten down the church.
Okay, yeah, the head priestess says, thank you very much, Padre. I appreciate the forewarning. Be careful if you're headed out there. She kind of looks past you and sees you have your horse readied.
Luz shall protect us.
And I'm going to swing by the tavern real quick and pick up two bottles of whiskey.
Okay.
And then yeah, sure. As I'm riding out, I'll toss one to Mad Dog.
All right.
Yeah.
I think, let me see here. I believe it's like 10 gold for a bottle of the top stuff, the top shelf stuff.
Well, the market toys.
Mad Dog doesn't drink top shelf.
All right, then.
Could reach it, doesn't need to drink it.
Exactly.
Do what?
You can't reach it.
Oh, there you go.
If it doesn't come out of a bathtub, it's not worth drinking.
If it doesn't have a chance of making you blind, then I want nothing to do with it.
Or if you can, also use it to peel paint. So, yes, a bottle of the fine stuff is 2 gold pieces, and a bottle of the common stuff... Oh, I'm sorry. The common stuff.
Stronger.
The common stuff apparently does not come in bottles. It comes in pitchers.
Perfect.
Which is 2 silver pieces.
That's his life. Yes.
You said 2 gold, not 10 gold?
It is 10 gold for a bottle of the fine stuff.
Okay.
Perfect. That's probably the Caved In Inn brand there.
Okay. He'll drink it if you throw it to him, but...
That's pretty good, strong dwarven stuff.
I'm actually kind of feeling pitchers come to think of it. I'm just going to grab 2 and go.
Two pitchers of whiskey.
And, I'll have to be a little more casual tossing it to Mad Dog, but
yeah, you we'll
kind of finagle it.
Slosh some on each other a little bit.
Put it on like aftershave.
It looks like a 5-gallon drum in the hands of Mad Dog. All right, so you guys head out west. Yep.
Yes, we're heading out west on our horses.
I tipped a gold piece because I have no intention of bringing this pitcher back.
Okay. Yeah, he probably starts to say something. Oh, I don't need to, and then he sees your coin on the bar and he says, "All right, have a good night." It looked like he was kind of starting to lock up, kicking people out.
Are like none of them boarding up the walls because of the storm thing?
Those that have seen it look like that's their intention. But most of the town is already asleep at this point.
And like people aren't waking other people up to deal with it.
Your drunk friend is.
Oh. See, I did the town a service.
Yeah, you did the town a service as Mad Dog lose inspiration.
As we ride out of town, I ask one of my compatriots to shoot off some rounds to get people's attention, and then I'll call out, "Beware the storm!"
I'm gonna light a stick of dynamite.
I look at the father and I say, "Can't you do this?" And I cast Thaumaturgy and yell, "There's a storm a-coming!"
And then kaboom, as Mad Dog's dynamite explodes somewhere in the outskirts of this small town.
Perfect.
I guess you're a band of monsters.
And now there is all kinds of pandemonium spreading throughout town.
God.
So,
well, we did our duty.
Oh my god. Alright. So you guys head out west. Alright, so you know that this is Shondo territory that you're riding out into. And you have wandered through here once before. What was that?
I said, do I know that?
Oh, maybe not. There is a standing bounty in town for Shondo scalps. 10 gold pieces apiece.
And the Shondo?
They are a tribe of Durathians.
Yeah, and I would definitely be telling them this because Shondo and I do not get along at all.
Mm-hmm.
So you would all be aware just because I'm with you.
Yeah, they hold a pretty significant... stretch of land. I'll bring up the map that has the tribes shown on it here. Hopefully this will do this automatically. But they're still, there you go. So yeah, the Shondo or the Red, They still hold quite a bit of land here. And if you see the where the towns and stuff are, there's not a whole lot going on in the middle of the Shondo territory. There's a couple of things that are kind of formed on the borders of it. But for the most part, they've been giving enough trouble to the eastern settlers here that people have kind of stayed away for a large part. They're very aggressive. And they aren't really known for taking prisoners. But this is not the first time that you have rode out into their territory. You did so once before from Wayward Gallows, whenever you were on the trail of Rinnerg, the Elf Eater. But then... this is a little different because before you were sneaking under the blanket of winter as it was starting to snow. But now you're kind of heading straight into the maw of the beast, if you will. You're a lot more centralized in their territory now. So you start riding out, and it's not very long before you start to feel the effects of the storm. You can feel the wind start to pick up as you're riding out. You still see quite a bit of lightning and thunder. You can kind of feel your hairs on your arms and the back of your neck and stuff kind of standing on end with the static electricity in the air as it increases. It's not long before the sting of rain starts to hit your face.
As we travel along, I start saying, like, scripture out loud.
Excellent. Okay.
And I'm going to the shield, the drum shield that I have is now on my back. It's kind of strapped to my back. Mm-hmm. But despite that, it is drumming, and it's kind of like beating out a writing cadence for us.
Excellent. Okay. Yeah, and so it becomes almost essential. So that you guys can kind of stay together and keep up pace as, you know, eventually the wind starts to drown out your ability to really talk to one another easily. And the rain is coming down hard enough that you're having some trouble seeing one another if you get too far enough away. But you ride on. Still looking up, kind of judging where you are, and eventually you pass under the edge of this column that's in the center of this storm. And when you do so, the wind dies down a bit, but the rain and the lightning is still coming with a pretty fierce frequency. But up ahead, now that the wind has died down, you hear a sound, and it takes a second. You have to pause, kind of strain your ears for a second, and then you hear it again. And then as you get a little closer, it's unmistakable that you hear the sounds of battle happening up ahead. And it looks like you're kind of riding towards a small gully. Looks like it might be left over from where a river once ran through here. But it looks like it has been dry for some time, though, you know, now the center of it is trickling again with this fresh rainfall.
While I'm running my horse, I'm going to hold on extra tight and then allow myself to leave my body and join my spirit animal and see through its eyes.
Okay. It's having a difficult time flying in this weather, but thankfully now that the wind has kind of died down a little here in the middle, it's able to kind of take flight again. And it does so, and you through it are able to see down, and it looks like that there is a a rather sizable host of Durathians that are engaged in conflict up ahead with a creature that you may or may not recognize, but it is essentially a minotaur.
Well, I can try and recognize it. Is that arcana or nature or religion?
Nature.
Nature. I definitely fucking know what it is. That I just got.
And while he's making that check, I know that the eagle does not actually exist in the material plane, so is it affected by the storm, or is it just like flying as normal,
preposterously? Normally, it would not be affected, and you have seen it do so in storms before with no adverse effects. But this storm does seem to be affecting it as if it were on the material plane.
Oh, man. Okay, so it's flying proud, but it's getting battered. That's a shock. Whew.
Yeah, it probably does set you back a bit. Okay. This is what this minotaur looks like.
Oh, he's a handsome fella.
And you can see that at least initially he was not alone. You can see two other minotaur corpses nearby, riddled with arrows and bullet wounds. Magic, essentially what would equate to scorch marks, you know, the presence of magical damage. but he is trying to give it his all. He is a little wounded, but he is trying to fight these things back, these Durathians back as they're pressing in on him. He kind of has a little bit of a geographic advantage. He has his back against kind of a rise in the land. And it looks like the cliff, the small cliff, it's probably only about 8 feet or so, extends a decent way in both directions. So it doesn't look like they've managed to outflank him. But it looks like he is quickly running out of time.
So I got a 20 on my roll. What do I know about minotaurs?
Minotaurs have lived in the caldera for a while, for quite a long while, actually. And they have adopted a lot of the Durathian ways of life, the way a lot of other woodland creatures have, like satyrs and nymphs and dryads and things of that sort. And they have kind of a close relationship with some Durathian tribes, as well as some elven tribes of people, but they have formed tribes of their own as well.
The tribes that they get along with, would that include the Kiyohe?
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool. So how much of that would I know myself?
You can make a religion or history, probably for you. Okay.
I'm going to...
Wait a minute, I have one more question. Do I know that those guys are the... What are they? The show something?
Shondo?
Do I recognize them as Shondo?
With what you rolled, I would say so.
Okay, so there is a minotaur who is potentially good or bad fighting things that I know are bad. I'm going to say that there's an innocent cow being attacked and we should go save him.
I'm trying to think what the likelihood is that I would recognize Minotaur from the description of innocent cow.
I'll say innocent cow man. A man cow. A Minotaur.
There we go.
There you are.
I got a 12 on my knowledge history roll, by the way.
You're hunting cow?
Okay. So, yeah, I would say that that you know that your people have had a pretty peaceful relationship with some minotaurs, at least, in the past. And they are a pretty noble people, typically.
Okay. Yeah, this can't stand. This guy needs help. But so he's the only one who can see the Shando. For the rest of us, it's just...
Well, I'd say that they're under attack by Shando. I say the cowman's being attacked by Shando.
Okay. Yeah, then I would spur my horse to go ahead as quickly as possible.
Okay. All right. So you guys kind of hasten the pace and push forward, and you kind of come up along a rise in front of you, and kind of looking down, you can see the edges of this skirmish unfolding, and you see the same things that Brother Cutter was able to see through the eyes of his familiar. He is kind of surrounded on three sides as these Shando are kind of coming at him with spears and tomahawks, knives, things of that nature. And a couple of them do look like they might have firearms. Some of them are hanging back, shooting arrows at him.
How many are there?
Of the Shando?
Yeah.
There's quite a bit. I would say there's probably about a dozen of them. Maybe a little more.
Well, as we pull up, I'm just going to immediately unload on them.
All right.
Well, when he shoots, I want to cast Thaumaturgy and yell out, "You're surrounded! Lay down your arms!"
Con artist.
All right.
So the Shando, are they like in a group or like three groups or how are they?
They're pretty spread out at this point. But yeah, I would say they're more or less in three groups. One that's kind of attacking him from the front and then one from either side. Like I said, some of them are kind of hanging back. They're not pressing the advance as much as most of the others. They kind of are almost treating it like their friends have it in hand, so to speak. But let's do this. Padre, you can give me a deception for your – we have you surrounded. And while he is getting that for me, and you as well, Padre, go ahead and roll initiatives.
Can I make that a persuasion instead of deception?
Well, you're telling them that you're surrounding them when you are not, in fact, surrounding them. So that would be a deception.
I'm trying to persuade them that I'm surrounding them. No.
It's deception. Get real.
Mm-hmm.
14 plus 1 is 15.
Okay.
True form, Padre.
Okay, so let's see here. We have Mad Dog with an 11.
Si, senor.
We have Eagle with a 21. We have Cutter with a 15. And Jane with a 19. Estevez with a 17. Okay. And a 1 for the deception. Okay. Essentially the way that I'm going to handle this is, even though they are technically involved in combat while this is happening, I'm going to give you guys a surprise round against them because they are not aware or actively engaging you in combat. So while they will be doing stuff, you are essentially going to be catching them off guard. Excuse me. So, up first, we have Eagle.
All right, so how far away are we from them?
Let's call it 60 from the, let's call it 40 from the nearest one.
40 from the nearest, okay.
Yeah, you're probably then, about 65, 70 feet from the Minotaur.
Okay. Then, yeah, I'm going to ride up and I'm going to take Natiquila, my tomahawk, and I'm just going to barrel past this first guy, but I am going to throw the tomahawk at him as I go.
Okay.
So that is a ranged attack. That's a 19 to hit.
Absolutely hits.
All right. And that is 6 damage total.
Okay. Yeah, so you catch him kind of square in the back, and he kind of whirls around from the force of the blow, and you catch this glimpse of his face as the lightning flashes of complete and total shock and surprise.
Good.
Okay.
And remember that? 6?
Yes, please. Thank you, Mike, by the way.
Yep.
Okay. Jane.
I am gonna delay and see how things unfold.
You got it. Okay. All right. One of the Durathians from the other side.
Aren't they surprised right now?
Yes, like I said, they are still taking action. They're just not taking action against you guys. So they are surprised when everything is concerning you. So what you are seeing is that this Durathian on the other side of the engagement is casting a spell at the Minotaur.
No.
And then fires a shot. But misses. Okay. Padre Estevez, your turn.
Was my surprise around my casting thaumaturgy and yelling out?
No, you did that just before this.
Okay. In that case, I will continue riding up, and how big of like a circle around this Minotaur is it? Like, how far away are they from this thing?
How far are the Durathians away from the Minotaur?
Yeah, and how far away are we?
Again, you guys are about 70 feet away from the Minotaur. They are right up against him. They are engaged in melee with him.
Okay. In that case, I will continue riding forward with the other people going forward, and I will say a prayer. Say, Luz, please bless my companions as we save one of your children. And I'm casting Bless on, I guess, Eagle Witness and Mad Dog and Jane.
Okay. All right, so yeah, you kind of, you say that, I don't know, do you have use a book as your symbol, or?
I have a rosary, and it's on my shield.
Okay, so yeah, you kind of hold your shield up a bit, and you speak these words, this prayer aloud, and this energy kind of snakes out from you, and touches each of these individuals that you named for the blessing of your god.
The light of Luz doesn't snake out.
I assume
it flies out.
It snakes out when it's heading to Mad Dog.
it kind of goes up to Mad Dog and then backs up for a second, turns around and looks at Padre Estevez like, "Are you sure?"
It's a little hesitant.
Does Eagle Witness try to save against the Bless?
Ooh.
I probably should. How do I do that? Will save?
You're getting caught unaware. You're no save. Just take it.
It's probably a wisdom save, if I had to guess.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and make one. That's a 5. I am blessed.
You failed. Now take your boon, damn it. All right. Okay, so the Minotaur kind of pulls this, what you see in the picture here, this, it looks like a log that's been carved with symbolic totem imagery. He takes it kind of from his back and spins it around to the front and grabs it in both hands and shoves the end of it, which is tapered and sharpened to a point. He drives it straight into the ground at his feet. And when he does so, he kind of throws his arms back and open and towards the sky. And a bolt of lightning comes out of the sky and hits the top of this this pole. And the ground all around him in a 15-foot area crackles with like lightning energy. And he is attempting to do Thunder Wave. So let's see here.
That's a really cool way to do Thunder Wave.
I'm sorry, I heard Derek. I did not hear whoever else spoke.
Oh, I just was joking. It's a do or do not, there is no try.
Oh, yes. So they have to make a saving throw. Let's see how they do here. They fail. So I'm fairly certain this is gonna kill. Okay, so the ones that are immediately around him, the ones that are engaged, take 20 points of damage and are flung backwards as their kind of charred and lightning-riddled corpses are flung away from him. They kind of land in the sand and the trickling brook that is starting to form nearby. And lie there smoking.
Damn, Kingsta.
Cutter.
Well, how fast can my horse moving around? Probably like 60 feet or something crazy?
60.
Yeah.
All right, so I ride up on my horse 60 feet, and then I jump off of it, and while I jump out, the magical glove I have ignites with fire, and then I close my fist, and the fire is absorbed into my hand, and I punch towards the guy who cast a spell earlier.
Okay.
And I am making a ranged spell attack. Ooh, 17. I'm pretty sure plus 6. 23. Does that hit?
Yes, it does. Absolutely.
I figured as much. And now we grab...
And just for... FYI, it is actually a female.
Well, it's not going to matter. It's going to be dead.
Corpses are dead. Fair enough.
12 damage.
Okay, remember that. Yeah, she's struck with this streaking ball of fire that rips out from your hand. And likewise, is caught very much by surprise as she kind of wheels around and looks in your direction.
If I jump off my horse, can I still move closer to the dude?
You can take a mount or a dismount once per turn, and doing so costs you half of your movement, so you would have half of your movement left.
Oh, great. So I can end up right next to the guy then. I end up right next to the guy.
Okay. yes, you are passing quite a few of them as you're riding towards him. So I'm going to say that there are two of them that are able to take opportunity attacks as you ride past.
They're surprised by me. They don't know I'm there. They can't take opportunity attacks.
Yeah, that's true. That's a good point. They will not do so this round.
Excellent.
Okay. It is the lower on the totem pole individuals, pardon the pun, turn, and they are going to close in where their brethren have fallen. Let's see. Okay, there are six of them that are going to be taking action. Wait. Yes. And three of them are charging in for melee. The other three are remaining back and using longbows. So there are two targets in front and center. Well, they will not be able to attack you this round because they are surprised. So they will be targeting the Minotaur.
I mean, I guess they're not that surprised by me anymore, since I just wrote out in front of them.
That's true. Okay, this one is at Cutter in that case. What is your armor class?
It is not that high. It is 15.
Okay, that is a hit. He comes up to you, kind of screaming, kind of a war chant, and brings the tomahawk down on your clavicle, dealing 6 points of damage.
Ow. Well, he is then caught in a explosion of holy fire.
Which hellish is fire damage. Hellish rebuke.
Hellish rebuke.
I don't think there's a save for that. I don't think there is.
There is a dexterity save.
Oh, okay.
And I hope he doesn't make it, because that might kill him.
I don't think he's going to. He got a 10 total.
No, he failed. He super failed. Okay, let's see. That's 16 points of damage.
Whew, that will absolutely kill him. Okay, so this one in particular individual, the first one runs up, swings, and completely misses the Minotaur, actually taking a small chunk off of the wooden post that he's kind of holding onto. The second one runs forward and buries this tomahawk into your clavicle. And then immediately afterwards, the ground beneath his feet kind of split open and this hellfire, this brimstone, you know, flame reaches up out of the ground and just completely consumes him. And
I choose to believe that that is just loses light coming from the ground.
It is, absolutely. If you would prefer it be more celestial in nature, we can certainly have it do so.
Well, I mean, it is Hellish Rebuke, and I get it as a warlock spell, not my cleric spell.
There you go. Okay, that was the second one. The third one who closed for melee is going after Brother Cutter. Okay, let's see. That is only a 13, so that will miss. Probably glancing off your armor?
No, I am protected by an energy field.
Okay, so yeah, it glances off of this energy.
Never mind. I changed it out for armor. No, I'm wearing the Mantle of Majesty now.
Okay, so yeah, it kind of glances off of your jacket, almost supernaturally deflecting the force of the blow.
I'm going to guess he swung at the jacket, expecting it to be made out of cloth, but it's made out of magic.
There you go. Okay, so as far as the longbow ones, two of them... Nope, all three of them are shooting at the Minotaur. So, let's see here. That probably ain't gonna do it. Nope. And nope. Okay. Two of them glanced off of his horns as he was kind of moving around, trying to not hold still. And the third one just completely misses altogether. All right. My dog, you're up.
All right. So Mad Dog's going to charge forward on his horse. And as he's going, he's going to grab the saddle horn and get his feet up on the seat of the horse. He's then going to grab something from his belt. And as he gets towards the perimeter of that thunder wave that the Minotaur had done, mm-hmm. As the Minotaur's arms are stretched out and he starts, you know, growling towards the heavens, I'm going to jump off of my horse and throw the healing potion that I just took from my belt into his mouth.
Okay.
As my daft hands, cunning action. So I'm going to use that as my bonus action, use item action.
Okay.
And then going to try to spin and shoot one of the guys while I'm still in the air, and then hopefully land somewhere near the Minotaur as my horse just runs off into the distance.
Okay, beautiful. Yeah, so you get enough of the potion in his mouth for it to do its full effect. And he kind of very much seems surprised, you know, like somebody would be if all of a sudden, you know, liquid was poured into their mouth. But as after a moment, he kind of seems to realize that, you're not meaning him harm, and is not going to do anything to you as you come into his space there.
So he will take 7 points of healing.
Excellent. I don't think that we have any damage that you have had to track on him yet.
No, but okay. he has like arrows and scorch marks.
Oh,
and...
yes, absolutely.
And then my Derringer shot would be at a 10.
That is not enough to hit. So it ricochets off of a nearby rock. But you absolutely do get a point of inspiration for that description of that attack. That's fantastic. So, yeah, a narrow miss, and you do stick the landing nearby, almost between his hoof and the totem, where it is put into the ground.
I want to actually try to use him as cover if I can, slightly. Maybe as totem.
Do what now?
Yeah, I want to try to use him as cover if I can.
I believe you can as a halfling.
Yeah, I can hide behind people that yep. are larger than me.
Excellent. And Derek brought up a good point. Did you add the D4 to your attack?
I did.
Okay.
It was just really bad.
It was just awful. Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. All right. So it is now some of the mid-level. All right. One of the Durathians steps forward, and you see him produce something that some of you might, for a brief moment, think could be a candle. Until you see a flame appear, and then it touches the wick of the candle, and then you realize that it is, in fact, not a candle at all. And he tosses this red non-candle at the Minotaur, and you see that it's actually a stick of dynamite. And I'm going to need the Minotaur, Mad Dog, and Brother Cutter to roll dexterity saving throws for me, please.
Mad Dog gets a D4 added.
Mad Dog's actually immune to dynamite damage.
Mm. Sorry. Yeah. No, he's actually awake at this point, so that doesn't count.
Ooh. So I failed. I got a 3.
Oh, no. Okay.
With my D4, I got... I have to add my bonus. Hold on. Sorry.
Okay, so you definitely succeeded. And the Minotaur also passed his. Okay, so the total damage is 16 points.
Actually, I forgot to add my bonus. It's actually a 7, so I'm sure I passed.
Closer, but not quite.
Can I use my reaction to Uncanny Dodge to take half?
Okay, yeah. Yeah, so you duck behind the totem, you know, being as versed in dynamite as you are, you recognize what it is a little bit sooner than the rest, and you know, peel off, put the totem behind you and the stick, and then when it goes off, you are completely shielded from the blast. However, the Minotaur will take 8 points. And Brother Cutter, you took the full 16. Is that correct?
Yep, but I'm not dead yet.
Okay, good. Yeah, your ears are kind of ringing a bit. Your vision's kind of slowly coming back into clarity as your whole world was kind of threatened to be torn asunder for a moment. But you got your shit back together. Okay, Eagle. Eagle Witness, you're up.
All right, so the Minotaur's got Cutter and Mad Dog right there with him. Mm-hmm. And I have just barreled past this dude that I threw Natiquila at. Are there any mm-hmm. chunks of Durathians anywhere that look like they need some punishment?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Then what I would like to do is take a page from Mad Dog and barrel toward those Durathians. I'm going to put my hand behind me and say, Natiquila! And the axe will fly out of the Durathian I threw the axe at and jump back into my hand. And okay. then when I get within, 10 feet or so of these Shondo, I'm going to similarly jump up onto my saddle, and I'm going to jump into the air. I'm going to spread my arms out, and the cloak that I got from Iskander with the rock feathers is like wings carrying me toward these people.
Okay.
And I'm going to use my ability, my mimic ability from my actor feet to make the cry of an eagle. And then as I come down, I'm going to like slam into the ground. And as I'm out here, I've got my axe in one hand and my knife in the other. And both of them have these like bright points of light that have come from the storm, like St. Elmo's fire. And so I make the cry and I slam down into the ground, and there's this huge rippling noise that bursts out from me as I do this. And so they all need to make constitution saving throws versus thunder wave.
Excellent. Okay. So let's see. What is the DC?
DC is 12, and it's for 6 damage total.
Okay. Okay, two of them passed, so they will take half of that and not be pushed back. The third one fails, so he takes full, which was 6.
Yeah.
And he is thrown 10 feet away from you. However, there's kind of a strange thing that happens. You're riding up, you jump up into the air and spread your arms out. Mm-hmm. And then as you begin to fall back to the earth, something really bizarre happens, and you see your body trail away from you down to the earth and make impact, casting this thunder wave, and then your body leaps back from the ground back up into the air. You are flying.
What?
Ego Witness is just going to fly right away now. This is what he's always wanted.
I'm going to make the cry of the eagle again. I guess okay. Everyone is technically entitled to a perception or insight check to notice that it's not really an eagle making the noise, but
I think it's pretty obvious.
That's delightful, though. That's great news.
Whoa, I just heard Eagle Witness's eagle, man. Also, my ears are bleeding, and so are my eyes, and I think that, yep, my nose is bleeding.
Jane, it is your turn. If you are, we're back around to where your turn would be.
Yeah, perfect. I will find a unattached group of the Durathians, ride that direction, and I'm going to, come to a stop with the horse and hop off the side and then step forward and burning hands the group, trying to encompass as many of them as I can.
Okay. All right. And that is a dexterity?
Yes, that's correct.
What is their DC?
The DC is 12.
Okay. Okay, one of them passed, and the other two failed. The one that passed looks like the one that threw the stick of dynamite.
Okay. The total damage for those that fail is 15.
Okay. So the two of those, you can go ahead and describe how they both go down.
Having recoiled from the blast of dynamite that was tossed away, they exposed themselves in the direction, towards the direction I was approaching from, and there's just no warning and no protection from the fire as it comes through and engulfs them. Lighting, you know, it burns through kind of pockets and what have you, and a couple of bullets and such go off as the forms just crumble.
Yeah, absolutely. The other guy manages to kind of get most of a chunk of rock kind of between you and it, and even though he manages to escape the worst of it, there are parts of him that do get blistered and singed. So that was Jane. Oh, Jane. Okay, yes, we are at the end of your turn. So you notice that there's a slight shimmer as you kind of return your hands from their casting position where they were doing burning hands. As you kind of bring your hands back, you almost see it like a second set of hands trailing behind the first set. And then you kind of look sideways for a second and you see what looks like another of you standing beside you. And it takes but a moment for you to realize that it's your brother. Your brother is the one that is your spirit guide, is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. And so basically, Eagle Witness, you have flight currently on you. James, you essentially have two copies of yourself currently going. We're just going to treat your brother as if he had stats that were just like yours. It'll just be easier to handle this way. Okay. The female Durathian has now taken notice of you and has seen your group's powers kind of be thrown about, and realizing that her people and herself might be in a spot of trouble, you see her kind of turn to either side and begin speaking to the air around her. And you see two spirit animals appear. One of them looks like an enormous snake. The other one looks like a large cat. And as you see the two different spirit animals kind of materialize out of this storm energy, for lack of a better description, she looks as if she's almost pleading with them. And in doing so, they turn from her and disappear into the ground.
A jump.
Okay, you jump. It is Padre Esteves' turn.
I will ride up, and as I get closer, I will try to aim my shotgun in a way that it gets like the most people as I ride by. So how many can I aim at as I ride by?
Four, apparently.
Okay. Then I will shoot that. I remember how to do that. Uh, 14 is the save.
Okay. Three of the lower level individuals failed, and the one that passed was again the higher level. So he will take half of the damage. And we'll say that two of them are at your closest range, and the other two are at your mid range.
How do you want me to roll that then? Just one at a time, and the first two will go for the long range, and then the third one will go for the...
Exactly. That's a perfect way to handle it. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, first two are 5, 6, 7, 8.
And I do believe that your dexterity goes into that as well, like it would with an right. ranged weapon.
So 9 for long range, or for mid range.
Okay, excellent.
And for the short range, 12.
Okay. So the mid ranged guy, the mid level guy, will take 5.
Has this guy been damaged at all, or is this a whole new group of people?
This is a whole new group of people.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And the one that is furthest away with him, that is over the lower level, takes the 9. And then, you what?
It was 9 for that guy, but how much for the other?
5, because he passed his save.
Thank you.
And then the two that were in the closer range took an additional, how much was it, Derek? Sorry?
It's, hold on.
It was 9, and then I didn't catch what the last 12, guy was.
12.
12 total, okay. Both of those guys go down, and you can feel free to describe that if you'd like.
Okay, so as I ride by, I shoot the Holy Ghost, and it's silent as bright colored lights just dash out and engulf these guys right in front of, or that are right there. And it's night out, so it's still really bright. It's brighter than some of the lightning going on, and it's all different colors. It's red, blue, yellow, green, all sorts of colors. And so they're just engulfed in this light, and it reaches the people further back too. But Padre doesn't stop to look at them because his friend is in trouble. So he keeps on riding forwards, and as he comes up, he yells, "Brother Cutter, Luz shall protect you, and I shall cast Healing Word on Brother Cutter as well."
Excellent. Okay, we're at the end of your turn.
Well, do you want to know how much Brother Cutter gets healed?
Yes.
No, just tell me.
It is... Hold on.
20?
No, not that much, unfortunately.
Oh.
9. That's not bad.
Okay.
So, I'm above half, so that's good. Hey, Jeremy, I have a question for you.
Go ahead.
Do spells get sneak attack dice?
No.
Okay.
I don't believe they can. I think it says specifically weapon attack, but I could be wrong about that, but I'm fairly certain that they don't.
Does my spell do anything odd?
Let me see if I can spin that into...
Do I see the hand of Luz reach down and...
Well... I don't see a way to spend what you did into the ability that I've decided to give you for this fight, but we'll just handle it this way. So you cast out your healing word, and you do see, you know, like a small opening in the storm cloud ahead above you, and it kind of comes down in a small concentrated beam that washes over Brother Cutter. And you find something inside of yourself, inside of your mind, that even though you didn't think it was possible, you now feel a stronger connection, a deeper understanding of your faith.
When the light kind of comes down, I'm assuming it's starlight, and so I'll say, and when Luz said, "Let there be light," the sun and stars sprang into existence.
Perfect. Take a point of inspiration, Derek. And in addition, for the remainder of this combat, you are able to turn any creature as if they were undead.
But using my turn undead ability?
Correct, yes.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so it is the Minotaur's turn. He pulls out 2 rather large axes that I ended up just calling warhawks. So they're rather large compared to what most people that you have ever come across would be able to wield. And he is going to stomp forward and try to attack one of the braves that's closed with him. That's a hit. And the other one is a hit as well. Okay. So he gets to add this to one of them. All right, so 5 points from his first attack. And then 10 points from his second one. So he kind of swings his arms out wide and brings both of the warhawks almost back together in what could probably be described as almost a scissoring action, and just dices this guy into three separate pieces. Brother Cutter, it is your turn.
Excellent. Are there two people within 5 feet of each other that are enemies that I can kill?
Yeah.
With magic? Great. So then I grab the gun off my belt, and I aim it at them, and it shoots out what you would expect a squirt gun to shoot out, if squirt guns shoot out glowing green acid.
All right.
And they need to make, I think, dexterity saving throws. Yes, they need to make dexterity saving throws, the two people.
Okay.
DC is 14.
Yeah, they both failed miserably.
Great. Then maximum damage. They can both take 12 damage and melt.
Yes. Both of them just kind of scream this ungodly noise as the flesh is kind of melted off of their bones. Your owl kind of has been flying around still, or?
Yeah, Seshet, flying around. Okay. Checking out the scene.
It kind of beckons you in a way to look through its eyes. And when you do so for a moment, it's almost like you're looking through two sets of eyes at once. At first, it's somewhat disorienting, but as you become a little more accustomed to it, you realize that you're kind of seeing things for how they really are. So for the rest of this combat, you are under the effects of a true seeing spell.
Oh, dope. Do I see anything that I wouldn't see normally? Like, is there anything weird going on yet?
Eagle Witness has some weird stuff going on with him.
Like he's flying?
Yeah, and it seems as though his eagle and he might be currently one entity.
Oh, dope. I'm also going to do one more thing. I am going to use my ability to speak telepathically to tell the Minotaur that we're here to save him.
Okay.
And it doesn't matter if he speaks any language I speak, he understands what I'm saying.
Yeah, in broken, somewhat broken common, he says, "Yes, I know. Fight."
Okay, great. I'm talking in his mind.
Yeah, he responded out loud, though.
Yeah, that's fine.
All right. So, okay. Not a whole lot of these guys, the lower ones at least, left alive. There are three of them remaining. And they certainly have their choice of targets. Let's see here. There are five of you guys. All right. Three. Okay. Is Brother Cutter yelling this out, or is this Alex?
Oh, yeah. He yells out, "Come on, hit me!"
All right. So one of them will be attacking you.
Right, he can die.
I don't want to be standing next to him at all.
Okay. It looks like one of them is actually turning his attentions to Jane. Although I guess Jane, are you still back? No, you ran up. That's right.
Yeah, I ran up. I'm closest to the one that threw the dynamite. So I went off and attacked that one group on its own, separate from everybody else. And I think you mentioned there were three of them total, and I killed two of the three. The dynamite, the chick that's showing being the one that's remaining.
Okay. So, yeah, the one that's attacking you then is apparently one from a different part of the battlefield. He will be shooting at you. And then the last one that's attacking currently is going after Padre Estevez.
Since it's not back to my segment yet, I'm still technically floating in air, 6 seconds waiting on my landing from the jump.
Okay. Let's see here. Okay, the first one was coming at Cutter. Let's see. Okay, he is shooting his longbow at you. Okay. All right, so he hit with a critical.
Okay. No, stop it.
Oh, balls. Okay. So he did max damage, which is a total of 18 points.
Well, he still gets Hellish Rebuked, so there.
Okay, good. He has a con save. Or dex?
It's still a dex save, yeah. Dex.
So was that 18 with the double?
Yes, uh-huh.
Okay, good.
He got a 17 on his dex save.
Well, screw him. He can take half damage still.
Okay.
7, 6, 4, 17. Half of that is...
So he'll take 9.
You can take 9 damage.
Okay.
And yeah, I'll fling my arm in his direction and then fall down on the ground. And when I fling my arm, he is erupted in fire, but I kind of miss because I'm losing consciousness.
Okay. Yeah, so, you rend some of the meat from his bones with this fire, this hellish / non-hellish rebuke. And then the world goes dark as you drop to the ground. I assume that means that you're at 0. Or are you
faking it? I'm at 0. I'm at 0.
Okay.
And also, it's definitely hellish. He just pretends it's not.
He's
delusional and crazy.
Okay. And then...
Who took that 9 points?
One of the remaining low-level guys. He was fresh.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, let's see here. Okay, I need to resolve the other ones. One of them was coming at Jane.
Starting point of 16 shield if needed.
Okay. You will need so. It is a 21 total.
Tie goes to the aggressor, so he still hit me.
With your shield?
Yeah, it puts DC at 21. But
I see him. Okay, yes. Okay. For 2 points. Apparently it slowed down quite a bit as it came through your magical deflection and just kind of barely punctured your skin. And the last one was attacking Padre Estevez. Okay. This one is a tomahawk. I doubt a 13 hits.
Nope.
Right. Okay. So, yes.
Does the activation of shield cause any additional trippy effects with my brother or otherwise?
I don't think so. Because he is, as of right now, a separate entity from you. So he wouldn't, mimic your movements or anything like that.
Cool.
Okay. Mad Dog. Your turn.
I'm going to use a cunning action to actually hide behind the Minotaur.
Okay. Go ahead and make your stealth.
Rolled a 17. Let's see here. Where's that? 24.
Okay.
Very nice.
And then I want to shoot at the girl that threw the dynamite at me, or the person that threw the dynamite.
Okay, that was not the girl. The girl's been the one that's been kind of spellcasting. But he is not all that far from her.
Okay. Yeah, I want to shoot the one that's throwing the dynamite.
Okay, go for it.
And I'm going to pull out one of my my blue guns to do so. And I'll just drop the Derringer that I shot earlier.
Okay, one of the patinaed guns?
Yeah. So with my D4, 22 to hit?
Yes, that will absolutely hit. And don't forget your sneak attack with that.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember what sneak attack at 5th level is. I think it's 2d6.
I think it is 2d6.
Okay. Thank you. Ooh. I just rolled boxcars and then hard threes.
Nice.
22 points.
It's 3d6.
Ooh.
Good for you. Dead?
And then yeah. Another 5. On top of that, so 28 points, or no, 27 points.
Whew. Okay. Yeah, this guy is still up and fighting, but you have messed him up. I don't think he had any damage on him already, did he?
Brian, burning hands.
That's right.
For 8 points.
Okay, so this puts him at 35?
He was at 35, yeah.
Okay. He is not looking good, but he is still conscious and fighting.
Is that not a check that we're...
No one throws dynamite at me.
The dynamite thrower was a guy. The chick was a spell slinger, or is a spell slinger.
Got it. I had them merged in my head, apparently. Thank you.
Actually, never mind.
Yeah. I have a picture of the... Well, it's actually not the guy throwing the dynamite. It's the other higher-level individual that's involved in the fight. There are two of them. The dynamite thrower and then this individual.
And who's that?
There are two of... Okay, so... Almost all of the low-level guys are cleared out at this point. I believe there are three of them left.
Oh, man, I've got a bunch of extra people that I'm tracking then.
Well, a lot of them have been killed.
Well, some of them have only taken, like, 3 points of damage.
Then that's on the three that are remaining.
Okay.
And then there are the two mid-level Braves, the dynamite thrower and this individual you see.
Okay.
And then there is the female caster who seems to kind of be their leader.
Okay. So we'll say that one's still left on Padre, one's still left on Cutter, and one's still left on Eagle.
Eagle is currently flying. One of them is kind of off by himself. That's the one that shot at Jane.
I have a track that Eagle dealt like 3, 3, and 6 to
some
different people.
I see.
Gotcha. So one of the people that he thunderwaved.
Perfect. Okay. Thank you.
Yep, got it.
I apologize for making that probably as confusing as it.
That's cool.
Okay. That is the end of Mad Dog's turn.
Correct.
Nothing happens, Mad Dog. I'm just kidding. Suddenly you're kind of overtaken with this feeling of almost rage, almost an animalistic need to kill. and kind of looking down at yourself, where you can see exposed flesh, you can see that your body hair thickens and sprouts. Your fingers begin to elongate, and your nails shift and harden and lengthen into talons. And as you're looking down at your body as this is happening, you realize all of a sudden that you can see a muzzle beginning to appear where your nose and mouth are. And your tongue, as it's kind of feeling its way along the inside of its mouth, notices that your canines, along with the rest of your teeth, have lengthened and sharpened. And yes, for the remainder of this combat, you are a werewolf.
What up? Oh, man. What does that entail?
Congratulations.
So?
Is that in the monster manual? I have a monster manual here. I don't have a player's handbook with me. It's at your house. But...
Okay. So, yes. For ease of mechanics and whatnot, the werewolf is listed on page 211.
Got it.
And we'll just run it stat-wise and stuff straight out of the book.
That works for me.
Okay. That brings us to the bottom of the round. And Eagle Witness.
Okay, so I attack three Durathians, and I hit one of them, but two of them resisted. And
okay,
how many of those are still alive at this point? Any of them?
I believe at least one of them. Yeah. I don't know if
I had them tracked at three hit points, or three damage, six damage, but some other stuff's been going on, so I think only one of those is left alive.
Okay, excellent. Then we're going to say the one with six damage is the one that's still alive.
Okay, sounds good. And then are there any other Shondo that are within, like, you know, 40 feet?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, cool.
I would say at this point the battle has probably knotted up pretty close. And everybody is probably within 40 feet of one another at this point.
Okay, so here's what I'm going to do. I am, first of all, just thrilled to death that I am flying. I am not making an eagle cry so much as I'm doing, like, some sort of Kyohei cry of like, my tribe or whatever. And I fly up into the air, and I do this, like, spread eagle type thing, and then I like, come up, and I lay on my back a little bit, and then I fall back down, and I'm going back toward the battle here. I've got my tomahawk in one hand, Nati Kuila, and I throw it at at one of the Shondo. So that's going to be poop. That's going to be a 9 to hit. Too bad.
Yes, that is unfortunately a miss. Yeah. You're kind of getting used to you're getting your air legs.
I'm going to throw in one that's of my inspiration. Fine. Reroll it.
You know what? I do have inspiration, so I will spend one of mine and reroll that.
Go for it.
This needs to happen. So I got a 12.
Okay. A 12 is unfortunately not enough to hit. It is enough to strike their armor.
Okay. I've got more tricks up my sleeve, though. So Nati Kuila just spins off into the storm. But Ayapa Kishuk's my dagger. It's still with me. And so I'm going to, like, fly down to this Durathian who's missing the six hit points. And I'm going to, like, spin around him in the sky. Well, not in the sky, but in the air. Spin around him and do two quick attacks, like one right under the shoulder and then one coming down the back or something like that.
Excellent.
Because Ayapa Kishuk's gives me a free attack.
Right.
And because I'm a two-handed fighter, a two-weapon fighter, I get to add my ability damage to that as well.
Oh, excellent. Very nice.
So, attack number one
you also get added
is a natural 20.
You also get added D4. You also get added D4 to your attacks.
The bless.
Nice. All right. For, and that's for damage, not for attack?
It is to attack.
No, it's not just attack. It's not damage.
Well, then you know what? That Ayapakishuk was actually a 14, or the Natiquila tomahawk was actually a 14. Does that hit?
Oh, yes, it does.
Wonderful. Thank you, Derek. So that's 3 damage against the one guy I threw it at.
He's still up. So
that's what I figured.
So you can still take stabs at him if you'd like.
All right. Well, no, I wanted to attack more than one target. So the second one, can I go ahead and keep this natural 20 that I rolled for the second attack?
Yeah, absolutely.
Wonderful. So, and then plus the D4 is a 3. I hit him. It's fine. So, damage. I am going to do 6, 7 for the first one. So that's actually 13 for the first hit. And then the second attack is a 12, 16 to hit the second time.
Yeah, that hits him again.
Wonderful. All right, damage. This time it's 7 damage.
Okay, so yeah, talk about how you Julian fries this guy.
Awesome. So Natiquila flies off once again into the storm, and then I swoop down and I come around. It's banking really hard, like right under his arm, as he raises up to like attack me or something. And as I come under, my knife is just trailing behind me, and I get him right under the arm. I hit him in some kind of artery that's there because science, and it's just like a gout of blood spurting out onto the dirt. And then, but at the same time, I'm already spinning around behind him. I come around and I do this little spinny thing and I come down right down his spine, open up his back. You can see his bones sticking out and he just falls to his knees and then his face is in the dirt.
Yeah.
Like the filthy Shondo he is. And actually, let me take that back. The second attack is not down his spine. I actually grab his hair and scalp him with one quick swipe of the sword.
There you go. Yeah. Nice. Dirty. You may take a point of inspiration.
Why, thank you.
Beautifully brutal. Jane, it is your turn.
Okay. I am largely ecstatic to see the full-on manifestation of my brother. And I'm going to look towards the female caster.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to say Travis, the cat, Eris, the snake, the bitch is mine. And I'm going to dart towards her. If the cat, I know the cat and the snake went into the ground. If they reappear, my brother will attack the cat. My hawk familiar will shocking grasp the snake. And then I'll action surge to have the additional action to take her with the sword.
Okay, excellent.
Attempt to just impale straight through her.
Go for it.
Okay, what do you want first? What of that is possible, etc.?
As of right now, they are beneath the ground, so we'll essentially just treat them as readying an action for now.
Okay.
And then go ahead and make your attack against her.
Okay, so I need. Okay, the attack against her is a 24.
Yes, it absolutely hits.
Okay. For 10 points. And the rest will cube.
Okay. I think that's the first that she's been damaged.
She is the female spellcaster, correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
She is currently at 12, and then you gave additional what on top of that? 10?
10.
Mm-hmm. So she's at 22.
There you go. Remember that. Okay. It is her turn. So she turns and levels her double barrel shotgun at Jane. And fires a shot, you will need to make a dexterity saving throw.
I rolled a one.
Okay. So, that is going to be full damage. So, okay. All right, so full damage is a whopping 10 points.
Okie dokie.
I rolled a 1, a 2, and a 3. Okay. So it's even though it looked as if you were completely caught off guard, apparently there was enough wind going on that she didn't level the shotgun quite appropriately enough and more or less just kind of winged you against your thigh.
Oh, she does have a sword in the belly.
That is true. That tends to kind of make your shotgun shots a little inaccurate. I'm not speaking from inspiration or from an experience or anything.
Well, you know, first degree burns can also help.
It's true. Okay. So, at this point, her two spirit guides do appear. But it might not be exactly what you think. Both of them look as though they have possessed two of the larger rock formations in the area, which now begin to shimmy and shake and break themselves away from the ground and then join the combat.
Yeah, if the descriptions are close enough to, or if the description of what they see is close enough to activate the ready,
yes,
a firebolt and a shocking grasp will be headed in their directions.
Okay, go ahead and do what you need to do as far as rolls and whatnot.
Okay, DC say on the shocking grasp. Oh, wait, sorry, they're both rolls. They're not. A 15 and a roll to 1.
Okay. The 15 misses against the thing's natural armor. And the 1 obviously misses.
Does he get to add a d4 to those? Are those attacks?
I didn't because it wasn't me. It was, I mean, they're kind of extensions of me, but...
Yeah, that's fine. Go ahead. You can go ahead and apply it.
All right, stand by. So the 15 becomes a 16. And the 1 is still a natural fail, so...
Right. And the 16 is still not enough to bypass. This thing's natural armor. Okay. So they spring up, and those attacks were both made at range, so they're not up on them. Is that correct?
The shocking grasp is touch. So the hawk is in melee.
Okay. All right, so we'll go ahead and resolve that one first. What is this armor class?
His armor class is 12.
Okay, that missed, barely. It kind of parts the air next to your familiar, causing it to kind of spin about in the air as this large rocky type appendage disrupts the air beside it. The other one is going to go after Padre. It makes its way over to you and is going to attempt to attack you.
Attempt is the word.
Okay. What is your AC?
20.
Okay. So it hits a 22.
Well, right when it tries to strike, I throw my arms wide and leave deeply in my lord, and my AC goes up by 5.
Excellent. So, yes, your faith protects you at the last moment as this rock kind of slams into this barrier that springs into existence between you and it, almost like pushing you and the field itself almost down into the ground with its sheer force and weight. Audrey Estevez, it is your turn.
So this thing, so it's this the snake then?
Yes.
Okay. So this rock snake just came up to me. And so as I'm standing there, arms wide, I will yell forth, let not the forces of Easel douse the light of Luz. And I will invoke my channel divinity to turn the creatures that are against me, that are within 30 feet.
Okay.
Is that everything within 30 feet? You said everything was pretty close to each other.
Yeah, I said everything was within 40. So the only thing that is outside of this area of effect is the chick, the spellcaster.
Okay. And so my DC, I guess it's a wisdom save.
Okay.
And the DC should be 15.
All right, so here's the remaining low-level guys. Wisdom, all right.
And anything with a CR of half or lower dies, apparently.
All right. Okay, so the low-level guys all failed, and they are beneath a half CR. So as you're describing how you kill the remainder of those guys, I'm going to roll up the saves for the rest of them.
Okay. So what happens is in this thundercloud, streaks of light actually come down and engulf these Shando. And it's sort of like, I'm going to say Indiana Jones, with their face starts to melt and they just melt in the light until there's nothing left of them.
Excellent.
And while you're rolling the other thing, I'm going to use a bonus action as well.
Okay.
If that is okay. And I will say, and the light of Luz was said to heal the afflicted. And I'm actually going to cast Mass Healing Word. And I can do that on up to 6 people, but I think there's only 3 of our party that are injured.
Okay.
So they will be the 3 healing.
Double tap it.
And they get healed. They all get healed 12.
Excellent.
That's precisely what I needed.
Does that include Hunted Cow?
Yes. I am including him.
Okay.
Was there anyone else hurt? I didn't think there was.
I was down 4 points, but...
Well, I'm not sure I want to help you at the moment. Actually, did I see you turn into a werewolf?
Probably.
I think you're hiding, right?
I think he's currently hidden.
So...
Am I still a small werewolf? Because
I would have killed you.
Do what?
I'm still like a small werewolf, right?
Yes, No. You're a cute, tiny little halfling-sized werewolf.
And do I still have my gear and my abilities as well?
Your gear transformed with you, but you still have it all.
Does he have malicious intent towards me? Because my turning things with malicious intent towards me, I guess, would affect him if he does that. Or do I have to know?
I don't think he has malicious intent. He might. That's up to Mike.
Well, I thought he had the intent to kill everything.
He is overcome with a bloodlust, is all that I'm going to pitch at him. I'll let him do with that as he pleases.
See, I didn't have malicious intent against everybody until you brought it up, and now I have to think about it.
Okay. Well, I mean, I didn't. I'm going to go with Padre didn't know you turned into a werewolf because you were hidden. And so if he knew you were hurt, he would have healed you as well. So you can heal yourself up if you want.
There you go. Okay. As far as the rest of those saving throws go. Okay. So the dynamite thrower failed. The the other individual, the one that's pictured currently passed, the one, the elemental that is fighting Jane's familiar failed, and somehow, don't ask me how, the one that is actually standing in front of you passed.
Okay, then. So they have to try to get away from me for a minute.
I thought the one that was pictured was the dynamite thrower. The other leveled one?
No.
Okay. I thought they were two leveled ones, the chick and the dynamite thrower.
There are three leveled ones total.
Got it.
Two of them mid-range, and then she appears to be their leader.
Perfect. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, let's see. So that was Estevez. And it is now the Minotaur's turn.
Real quick, for clarification, the wolf head guy, who is he the closest to currently? I don't know if he's been damaged at all.
I don't think he has. So he is kind of off by himself as far as engagement is concerned.
I just wanted to make sure that I wasn't missing damage on him.
I don't believe so. I don't think anybody has even targeted him yet.
Okay.
Okay. So let's see here. All right. So the Minotaur is actually going to try to see if he can't deal with this guy. From where he is, he actually hunkers down and lowers his head, stomps at the dirt twice, snorts, and then charges forward at this guy. Okay. And hits him. For 7 points of damage total. Oh, wait. Because he charged, he gets an additional 2d8. Okay, 15 total. So now this guy does have damage on him.
Did, I don't remember if he passed my channel divinity, did he?
This individual here?
Yeah.
Anything
injured, anything that takes damage is no longer affected by it.
Yeah, I think he was the one that passed, and the guy that threw the dynamite had failed.
Okay.
If I'm recalling correctly. Okay, so that was the Minotaur's turn. Oh, okay. He also has to make a strength saving throw, which he fails. So he is also pushed back 10 feet. So the Minotaur lowers his head, charges forward, and gores this guy with his horns. And the guy is just doing his best to try to kind of keep his horns away from him as he's just kind of pushed backwards in the dirt until his back is up against a rock. Brother Cutter, it is your turn.
Well, even when I went unconscious, I could still see because I was seeing through the eyes of my owl. And so when I actually come to consciousness again, I already know what I want to do, that I point my gun over at the lady and I yell out psychically to kill the spellcaster, and then I shoot her with Eldritch Blast.
You yell out psychically to whom?
Everyone. Everyone. Oh. Even the bad guys.
Got it.
And does 18 hit her?
Yes, it does.
Okay, and does... Well, that's 18 again, so yes. She can take... 10 damage.
All right.
Puts her at 32.
Okay, remember that.
And I'm going to just stay laying on the ground where it's nice and safe.
Fair enough. Okay. Okay, there are no more of the low-level guys left, so they will not be taking a turn. That means, Madball, it is your turn.
I'm going to charge after the Minotaur.
Okay.
And I'm going to run up his back and then jump off his head.
Mm-hmm.
With my newfound strength, I can long jump after running up to 15 feet. So I'm going to clear the 10-foot gap that he knocked the wolf head guy
back. Okay. Yeah.
And then I want to try to catch him with my claw on the shoulder and rake down his back. And then with my multi-attack, then bite him on the ankle once I've reached the ground behind him.
All right.
Because there can only be one wolf in this fight.
I will say that for your first one, because he completely does not see this coming, you can have advantage.
Oh, awesome, because I rolled a 7.
And you get added a d4.
Which I rolled a d4. Thank you.
And he doesn't see you, that means sneak attack.
Non-20?
Yep, that hits.
Awesome. So, close a d8. So this is with sneak attack, correct?
Yes, it is, because you have advantage on this.
So that'll be 11 points on the claw.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I rolled from the bite. Let me 13 points.
Okay. What does that put him at?
It's at 28.
Okay, remember that. He is still up.
So then the bite.
This one is not at advantage, just to clarify.
Correct. 19.
That is enough to hit, though. Go for it.
7 more points.
Okay.
So it puts him at 35, and he needs to make a constitution saving throw at a DC of 12.
And I just made that, and he rolled a 20.
Okay.
So he saved. So I believe you said he was at 30-something? 38, 39, something?
Oh, sorry, I was meeting 35.
35, okay. So yes, he is still in this fight as of now. Okay. That was my dog. Okay, it is their turn. All right.
So everything that failed my thing is supposed to dash away from me.
On their turn?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So the dynamite thrower turns. They can still attack and stuff. They just cannot come any closer towards you.
It says they can't take reactions. For its action, it can use only the dash action or try to escape from an effect that prevents it from moving.
Excellent. Okay. So this guy actually takes off and runs over to a small place that's somewhat off to the side and hops onto the back of a horse and whips the horse into a frenzy and takes off directly away from your group.
I don't think they actually have to like leave the area. They just have to like get away from me like 30 feet, don't they?
Well, this guy apparently has taken that as a sign and has taken his leave of this battle.
Okay.
However, the other one that is now now engaged with Mad Dog will. Does rage take an action to go into? Does anybody know off the top of their head?
No, it's a bonus action.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. So he will be using his bonus action to enter rage. He then pulls out a war club and is going to attempt to bludgeon Mad Dog with it.
Not our group puppy.
He has advantage on, oh no, on strength rolls, not attacks.
No, not Scrappy-Doo.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I want to call Mad Dog now, Scrappy-Doo.
Nice. So in this form, do I have the benefit of my my poncho that gives me plus one to AC or my armor?
Your armor is normal.
My armor is leather.
Okay, so I'm going to say that the poncho, because it is magical, will qualify, but the armor will not because it is not magical.
Perfect. So instead of a AC of 12, I have an AC of 13. So that on my text is incorrect at the moment.
Okay, that is a hit.
Okay. Is his weapon magical or silvered?
No, it is not.
Then I will take half damage.
Okay. So, 8 is full damage.
Bludgeoning. Oh, excuse me. Damage immunity is bludgeoning, piercing, slashing damage from non-magical weapons that aren't silvered. So I take 0 damage.
Okay, so yeah, it hits against your skin, and you're expecting it to hurt. And it does sting a bit, but you take no damage from it. Okay.
Hell yeah, I want to be a werewolf, Padre.
Okay, so that is his turn. And that brings us back to the top of the round with Eagle.
All right, how far away is this guy trying to get away?
As of right now, the horse can go 60, so he's about 50.
Okay. Do I get an increase to my speed with the flight ability, or is it still my normal speed?
I don't know. Let me look at the spell. I think you can fly at 60.
All right.
Double check real quick. But go ahead and plan out what you're going to do.
Well, ideally, I would like to chase after the motherfucker and hit him with 3 attacks. So,
if it's the spell, it is 60.
It is, yep, it is 60. So, yes, it is functioning as the spell.
Well then, buddy, you think you're getting away from us? It's this wolf guy, right?
No, it's the other guy. Yeah, the dynamite choker.
Oh, even better. Okay, so Eagle Witness is going to barrel down on this dude from the skies.
Like Falcor.
Yeah, exactly. So... yeah, he's going to get close to him. He's not going to throw Nightiquila this time. He's called it back, of course. Mm-hmm. He just got the two of them, and he's going to slash with his knife and then come the other direction with the tomahawk and then turn the knife over and slash back for a 1-2-3 punch. So first one is the knife, Iapakishuks, and that is a 6 to hit.
That's not going to hit.
Do you get a d4?
I did not. So it's actually a 7.
It's still a miss.
Figured. Okay, so trying again, and that's the exact same roll. So the first one did not hit. Fuck it. I'll spend one more inspiration. And that was 11... 13 to hit this guy.
It is another miss.
God. Okay, fine.
It's by 1 point.
This one's not Tequila. And that is a 14.
That's enough to hit on the nose.
Wonderful. All right. That's going to be 7 damage against him with not Tequila. And then Ayapakishuks is coming back. That's a 1. I'm going to spend my last inspiration on that stupid roll. And that's another 1.
Oh my gosh.
No. Jeez Louise.
I was not meant to hit him.
Apparently not.
But hey, I'm flying alongside him. Yeah, now.
You are just so into this flying thing. You're like, I can't even be mad, bro. Like, you know, just...
I'm not. In fact, I'm laughing.
The So he's now at 42.
Okay. Oh, that is actually enough to kill him.
Wonderful. Okay, so I whiff on Iapakishux, but then I come back with Natiquila and catch him in the neck, and the blade hits, and the blade, here, let me show you. I don't know if you're going to be able to see it very well, but the blade of the tomahawk is more like an arrowhead or something, right?
Very nice.
So it embeds itself like right in his neck, and I can't get it out, so I'm just going to yank it down to where he falls off the horse onto the ground. And yeah, that's that.
All right. Yeah, the horse kind of rides on, trying to get away from this flying person.
Good luck, horse. I'm coming after you next.
Cackling madly.
And that does it for me.
All right. That brings us to Jane.
How does the chick look?
What is she at?
She's at 30.
30 something? She looks like she's still doing all right.
Okay. I'm going to follow the stab up then with a shotgun blast.
Okay.
And then my brother will fireball.
Still at the golem, or is he turning?
No, he's going to focus on her with me.
Okay.
For the shotgun, I rolled a 20.
Oh, there you go. That's a 20 on the total attack, or you rolled a 20?
No, I rolled a 20. So oh, 20. It's just plus dex, or is it? I forget what we add to the shot. Is it my full attack, or is it?
As long as you are proficient with shotguns, which I believe everybody is.
I am, yes.
Everybody are. Everybody is, yeah. So, yes. So, but that does count as double damage.
DC is 26.
Okay.
And double damage will be 20.
Okay, she failed. So... 20 is the total doubled?
20 is doubled, yes. Okay. Rolled for 10 and doubled.
All right, she will take all of that.
The firebolt attack is a 16.
That is a hit as well.
Okay, and that will do 7 points.
That's
59. Okay, remember that.
And I am done.
Okay. It is her turn. She is going to... Let's see here. Okay. She uses her bonus action and moves the Hunter's Mark spell that she had on the Minotaur onto Jane, and then empties the second barrel of her shotgun at him.
Don't forget you get to add a d4 to your save.
For a total of 20? Is that hit your armor class? Jane, does a 20 hit you?
Oh, shit, sorry. I didn't realize you were talking to me. It will, but I will activate shield and not take it, burning my last spell slot.
Oh, wait.
It's a shotgun. It's a shotgun, right?
Yeah, it is okay. A shotgun. Yeah. So you only need to make a saving throw. That's right.
So save. Okay, sorry.
But you will get a d4 from Estevez's...
Even with the d4, I failed.
Okay.
So. But I have my spell slot back, so that's good.
And then the Hunter's Mark is a D6, I believe. Okay, so full is 17 points of damage. She levels this shotgun in return and fires So the two of you are just like almost dancing around each other, just blasting each other with shotguns at point blank range. It's not very pretty.
Like you do.
Exactly. It's like a Tarantino film in this bitch. It's getting bloody up in here.
And how much was the damage again? Sorry.
It was 17 total.
Ouch. Okay,
what is Gene Nick, Brian?
I'm back down to half.
Okay.
Padre Estevez, it is your turn.
A hair less than half.
Do you think you could stand up to another round?
Sure, why not?
Because I want to do something else. Okay, so while they're doing that, I will stare at this snake golem in front of me, and what I will say, a verse from the Good Book of Luz, chapter 13, verse 8. For Luz's light is like the edge of the celestial sword or blade. Is that weird? And I will cast Spirit Weapon, but I'm actually going to cast it on like right above the caster woman.
Okay, I see.
And so it is going to be a spell melee attack.
Mm-hmm.
And 18.
Yes, that absolutely hits.
Perfect. And I believe it is a 1d8 plus my spellcasting. I'm going to find a d8. Ooh, 10. 10 damage.
Okay. It puts her at like 67, something like that.
To the spellcaster?
Mm-hmm.
It was 10 points?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
69. Yeah.
Nope. Derek, you just won D&D. Congratulations.
We're adult games.
Yep. Because it's a number. That's why. Okay. So, yeah, she's still up, though. She does not look good.
So what happened, though, was
the sword
like dropped down onto her shoulder. We'll say that.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, she kind of lets out this kind of feral scream.
And at the same time she screams out, I will shoot the Holy Ghost at this freaking rock snake in front of me. It's an onyx, I guess.
Okay, go for it.
And this, the save sucks. The save is an 8.
An 8. And it is a dexterity save. You might be in luck. Let's see. Okay, not quite that lucky. All right. So he passed, but he will take half.
Yeah. He will take half of 10, so he'll take 5.
And your shotgun is currently magical. That is correct?
It is.
Good deal. So he will take the full half instead of a quarter.
Perfect.
So yeah, you kind of blast a chunk of rock out of kind of this snake's midsection, the coiled rock in front of you. Okay, the Minotaur. He is going to move into a flanking position around this wolf-headed Shando, giving himself advantage with Mad Dog to his next attack. Both of his attacks. He's using his Warhawks again. He rolled a 1 on one of them, and the other one will hit. So this guy will take 13 points of slashing damage.
That puts him at 48.
And, okay, he rears back as this guy is kind of recoiling in an immense amount of surprise by the fact that you seem unfazed by his club blow. And he kind of staggers back for a second. And the Minotaur all of a sudden just comes. You see the Minotaur's kind of almost his shadow, like, rise up behind this guy, easily towering over him. And he brings these axes down, and one of them misses entirely, but that's only because his body is already crumpling to the ground under the weight of the one that hit first. And it cleaves him from his shoulder down to the base of his pectoral muscle as he drives this massive warhawk down through his ribcage. And that guy is no more. Okay. Brother Cutter, it is your turn.
Well, following my own sage advice, I'm going to kill the caster. And I think I will just use more Eldritch Blast. Unless I have something that deals more damage. Ooh, I do. I'm actually going to use Poison Spray. She needs to make a Constitution saving throw.
Double check the range on that. I think it's pretty close. I may be wrong about that.
Yeah, it's 10 feet. I just crawled over to her. It's fine.
Fair enough. You very, very discreetly wiggle your way along the ground so you're close enough. Extend your hand out and splash poison.
Yeah, it's actually a spray poison. I shoot my gun. It's swart gun's poison this time.
Ah, I see.
But it's like a swart gun of gas. So like a gas gun. Got it. Just hits her in the face.
It's like a
dissipates.
Yeah, like a Joker thing.
Like a Joker thing. Exactly like the Joker thing. The gun even like has a flag comes up that says bang, but then the flag disintegrates.
Is it a saving throw or an attack roll?
Saving throw, Constitution.
Constitution. At a DC of what?
Big, really big number, 14.
That is what she rolled total.
I don't know who wins that. Do I win that? I think it's the roller wins, right?
It's usually the aggressor, but in a saving throw situation, that is just a target DC that she has to achieve.
Yeah, that or better.
Which she did. So I think
she can still take. She can still take 9 damage.
9 is already halved?
Yes.
Okay, excellent.
Well, I mean, it's halved plus 0.5 because you round up.
Yes, I always round up in y'all's favor and down in the bad guy's favor.
That'll put her at 78.
Okay, remember that. Yeah, she is.
No, she's dead.
Her skin bubbles at the surface, and she screams and howls in pain, but she is still with it.
Does she cough up some blood because it's poison?
Absolutely. Yeah, her eyes are kind of bulging out of her head, Arnold Schwarzenegger style from Total Recall.
Never saw that movie.
I'm sorry, you're missing out. You make me wish I had 3 hands. That's all I'm going to say.
I haven't seen, like, any movie. I don't interact with social media or television.
All right. Fair enough. That was Brother Cutter. Mad Dog, it is your turn.
So I'm going to turn and jump on the Minotaur once again to like pounce off of him like I've been doing.
Okay.
He's apparently my jungle gym. So as I'm running up him, gonna get towards his shoulder. And I'm going to sink my teeth into his neck. So he needs to make a defense.
You're going to bite the Minotaur. Okay. Make your attack. You are on him, and at this point, he doesn't realize that you mean him any harm. So you can have advantage.
25.
That'll absolutely hit him.
Okay, about. Sixteen points.
Okay. He takes 16 points of damage.
And he needs to make a constitution saving throw.
I'm actually not even going to roll it. He fails because the idea of having a werewolf minotaur is too good to pass up.
You said there'd be two or three more sessions. Werewolf minotaur DM controlled.
So I shouldn't heal the minotaur, is what you're saying.
If you can cleanse it, cleanse it. Otherwise, we're in trouble.
Absolutely heal the minotaur.
He howls out and drops his warhawks and grabs a hold of his neck and kind of shoves you off of him onto the ground. Says, "What the hell? Well, we're on the same side."
I'm just going to growl at him.
Is there anything else that you're doing, bonus action-wise, or anything like that?
I technically have multi-attack, but I'm going to keep myself in somewhat check and not lash out at him again. Just brief moment of not realizing what was going on.
Okay. But you are making no move to get away from him or anything like that?
Yeah, no, nothing.
Okay.
For now.
All right. So, I think both of the mid-range guys are also now dead. Is that correct?
Yes, correct. The dynamite and the wolf head guy?
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Okay.
But it should just be the female spellcaster.
And her two golems, which yeah, the cat one is running away.
And the golem.
Okay. So, Eagle, it is your turn.
Okay, so time to head back to this sorceress piece of crap. All right, so I'm going to fly back to her, recovered my weapons, and I think I'm going to. Well, wait, how? So he was about, the guy on the horse is about 60 feet away. Was he right next to her whenever he took off?
No, he was probably about 20 feet away.
Okay, gotcha. In that case, then, I will I'll fly back toward her, but I'll go up into the air maybe about 10 or 15 feet so that I'm up above a little bit, and I'll just chuck Natiquila at her. So, that, ooh, a natural 20. Okay, so then.
What?
It's either, like, great or terrible, these rolls tonight. So it's 24 total. Plus, you know, the 2 for whatever.
You definitely hit.
All right, let's roll some damage for this stupid thing.
We'll do double damage.
That is 9 damage total with the double included.
Wait, no, it's not.
Ability damage is not doubled, right?
The way that I do it, it is.
Okay, then it's 10 damage.
So 88. That's to the spellcaster chick, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Remember that. She looks like she may be on her last leg. She's stumbling around, blood coming from several different wounds. She's looking like she's almost disoriented. And she definitely looks like she... The fight is leaving her. Jane, it is your turn.
Okay, I'm going to burn second wind to regain some hit points. I am then going to drop, seeing the state that she's in, I'm going to drop my shotgun, pull Soul Shackler, cycle it and smile at her kind of out of the corner of my mouth, and be mine forever. I'm going to put a round in her head.
Okay.
And I'm going to hopefully put around in her head. Actually, I'm going to burn a point of inspiration. and with inspiration, it is a critical.
All right. There you go.
Okay. So 2d6.
So 22 total points of magical soul-stealing bulletness.
I believe that puts her...
So she was at 88, so...
110. Yep, go ahead and describe what happens next.
Okay, as the bullet makes contact with her and the life starts to fade from her body, a second emanation from the barrel of the gun, the form of a chain, a spectral chain, fires out, kind of trailing behind the bullet and begins wrapping into her. If I may, I'd like to burn my last point of inspiration to attempt to extend that to her. Well, I'm going to burn the point anyway, but I'm going to attempt to extend it into her spirit companions. And so if that works, then chain will strike to them. If that doesn't work, the chain will just grab her and cycle her into the formerly spent cartridge.
Okay, so yeah, you point the gun, fire, and the bullet ends her life. And as the soul begins to come out of her, the rock golems collapse to the ground. We're going to need some saving throws. But the spirits emerge from those and turn and fly or run directly towards her, looking like they're going to try to save her or gather her up. And as they close, the chain that is wrapping around her shoots out away from her, almost like chain lightning, and connects both of them. And all three of them are pulled into the gun.
Excellent, thank you.
So, we are out of combat. We are two and a half hours in. So we are going to go ahead and take our 10-minute break now. And when we come back, we will deal with the aftermath of that fight.
When we take a break, can we take a short rest too?
No, not yet.
I was going to say, they're still werewolf.
So I will be back in just a bit.
Jeremy, I'm listening to this Spotify playlist you made for Caldera, and I'm loving it.
Excellent. Glad. I'm glad that somebody else is getting some use out of it.
Mm-hmm. I've listened to it every time we've played, actually, and it's been great.
Nice. Yeah. Some of the ones that I put on there are, as far as just Westerns, are some of the best soundtracks.
Mm, absolutely.
I can't find some of the ones that I would like to include. I don't know if they would be good or not, but stuff like Tombstone and Wyatt Earp, I couldn't find them through Spotify. Or I think Unforgiven was another one that I looked for and couldn't find. Which I don't know if you've seen Unforgiven, but it's probably one of the best Westerns out there.
I have not seen it. I really? Unfortunately, woefully underexperienced when it comes to Westerns.
It was, I think, Clint Eastwood's second movie to direct, if I'm not mistaken. It may have been this third one, but I mean, it's his return to the Western genre after doing all the spaghetti, the spaghetti Westerns in the 70s. But
nice.
Man, it's him and Morgan Freeman and Gene Hackman. And it is all kinds of awesome from start to finish.
Sounds like it. Every time I think of Gene Hackman in a Western, I can't help but think of The Quick and the Dead.
Quick and the Dead. Yep.
It's not maybe the most serious Western movie, but God, I love it.
It's a really fun.
I liked it.
It's a really fun premise.
Yeah.
There's actually two different movies that are Westerns called The Quick and the Dead. And that's one of them. And the other one is, I think it's the woman that married Steven Spielberg after she was in Indiana Jones 3, or Indiana Jones 2, Kate Capshaw, that's her name. And yeah, I think Sam Elliott is one of the leads, the male leads in it. It's also a pretty good Western, but it's much more like the Wagons Westward kind of movie, where it's kind of a slow like journey through the roughness of the frontier.
I hate to interrupt, but you said the name of a movie I've actually seen. I've seen Indiana Jones. Wow.
That's good. Indiana Jones is a fantastic movie to have seen. If you're going to have a limited repertoire of movies that you've seen, Indiana Jones.
Is a good one to have on that list.
Yeah, yes. In your collection is what I said. Sorry. Unless, of course, it's Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. In which case, if that's the only one that you've seen, it doesn't really count.
I've seen all of the Indiana Jones movies and all of the Star Wars movies, and that's probably the only thing I've seen all of the movies of.
Again, very, Lord very good Rings? Selections.
Do you have Lord of the Rings?
You should definitely see Lord of the Rings if you have not. Being a D&D player, it's kind of a rite of passage.
Yeah.
Hello. I forgot about that. Yeah, the Lord of the Rings, too.
Oh, there you go. Good. Here are some of the big ones.
If you watch the Hobbit movies, you have to watch the third one with the extended cut, because otherwise you have no idea where the hell those goats come from.
And that's the most important part of the movie.
What goats are you talking about?
I love the fact that they got Billy Connolly to play the Dwarf King.
Yeah.
It was so awesome.
Pretty good.
Okay. Everybody's back except for Bri. Bri said that he had something at work that he was going to try to knock out in the interim of this break. But he said it was very possible that it would run a little over. But since that's kind of what's keeping him at the office, I'm going to say that it's perfectly okay that he takes care of that.
To answer your question in chat, I had six different little guys that I actually wrote down and was tracking damage on, and then six of them that we just outright killed. So I'm pretty sure it was about 12.
Good. That's how many they were supposed to be.
Perfect.
Cool.
So I managed to somehow track that correctly then.
Because you're awesome. You can have a point of inspiration. Which is honestly for your
a miracle, bed. Because I got super fucking confused, like, the second round in.
Luckily, Mike has been playing with me for over 15 years, so he's kind of used to my weird, eclectic bouncing around enough that he apparently was able to read my thoughts. So, did you get your point of inspiration for that, Mike?
I'm capped.
Okay, fine. Then, in other words, go fuck yourself.
Sorry.
What's the cap?
Oh, that's right. Yeah, there is no cap for Caldera.
Then I'm boom.
Yeah, we haven't been playing with one in Caldera, so.
Yeah, because I think I have 11 built up.
So you'll take it and you'll like it.
Oh, yes, I will. That's why I was trying to give it away earlier.
Give it away now. Okay.
Hit so, 8 on Skull before he decided to be a monk.
How do you guys hold on to inspiration? This is crazy. I've never had more than like 4.
I don't think anybody else has been using them all that much, sadly.
Because re-roll them when you fail. I don't.
It's because when I miss an attack roll, I'm like, whatever, who cares? And I save them for saving throws.
It's like those potions that you get in video game RPGs. You're like, I don't want to use my healing potion yet. And then you finish the game and you have like 59 of them in your inventory.
Yeah, I always have to have, like, whenever I play games like that, if I use something, and it's like, well, my next opportunity, you got to go stock up on everything again.
Yep. I got to carry the exact maximum of everything that I can have.
Yep.
And I will never use a single one of them.
You know what I've been doing in some other games recently, because I know about that? I've sold every single potion I've got, because I know I'm not going to use it.
Yeah, there you go.
And now I have such bitchin' gear all the time.
Okay, so are you guys ready to get back into it?
Ready.
Oh, I'm ready.
All right, so Jane finishes the remainder of the exchange with a gunshot from Soul Shackler to the head of the caster, who was apparently leading this band of Shondo. And as she collapses to the dust, and her spirit leaves her body, the chain comes out of Soul Shackler, wraps itself around her, shoots out and attaches itself to both of her spirit guides in addition, and all three of their spectral forms are pulled into this gun and disappear.
Padre Estevez fails to see that for some reason.
Okay.
Excellent. Looking at how much blood I'm still kind of oozing.
Yeah, he's going to tend cutter.
Oh, Estevez was fighting one of the golems, was he not?
I was.
Okay. So you're going to need a saving throw, and this might explain why you failed to see this collapse, or why you failed to see these spirits be sucked into the gun.
Well, I rolled a 2.
Okay. So that's not going to be enough to avoid the rubble that collapses down upon you as this golem unforms. 10 bludgeoning damage is full.
Is it non-magical?
It is non-magical.
Okay, then it's reduced by 3.
Okay, so yeah, you'll take 7 then of bludgeoning. So yeah, you kind of, you know, put your arm up to shield yourself, and you're able to deflect some of it, but you know, a couple of large sized chunks of rock manage to come down on, you know, on your toe, on your back, maybe on, you know, the top of your head, enough to bang you around a bit. The other one had been running, so it was out away from everyone whenever it collapsed. So, the Minotaur has rounded on Mad Dog and is looking like he is going to fight him. So, is there anybody that wishes to do anything about that?
I bleed in his direction.
Okay, he's intimidated.
Good. What? Let me make an intimidate check. Hold on. Nineteen.
Oh, okay. Never mind. He's not.
Okay.
I definitely would like to try and talk to this Minotaur guy, but I get the impression that Mike is not going to be down with that.
Well, I don't know that he's going to be able to prevent you from talking to him.
Well, yeah, but I mean, he's just going to keep attacking him, so I think...
Maybe, maybe not. You never know.
Okay.
Maybe I just want to...
I'm going to get up and roll persuasion checks. So I'm I'm gonna get up and run between them and be like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Scrappy, chill. Big cow, chill, chill. It just got a little confused there. Right? Right, little puppy dog? Just got a little confused. Please don't bite me.
And
I got a 19 actually again. Wait, okay. Is he Eastern? Is this an Eastern cow from the East?
It is not.
You sure?
Yes, he is very much. 22? He is very much Calderian. Calderian, whatever the term for that would be, of the Caldera.
Lava. Lava man. He's a lava man.
There you go. Okay. Yeah, he seems like he's still pretty pissed about the fact that Mad Dog bit him. But it doesn't look like he is outright going to aggressively pursue fighting him. He's okay. Definitely looking like he's more like defending himself at this point.
So what does Mad Dog do? I'm more interested in.
That's a good question.
You are bleeding pretty bad, right?
Yeah. I haven't been injured kidding. Since the last time I got healed, so I don't know. Am I still?
I was kidding. Anyway. So Mad Dog's gonna have wild eyes, and he's gonna kind of sniff the air and just try to figure out what's going on a little bit at the moment.
Who are there still people who are injured?
I just stubbed my toe.
Oh no.
I mean, if we can take two short rests back to back, I can top myself off.
Well, I have a prayer cast, so 30 feet. Gets, hold on a second. 6, 7, 8. So everybody gets 10 hit points back.
I just rolled. Mad Dog's gonna bolt.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
He's gonna, until this werewolf goes away, he's just gonna pillage and go do stuff in town or whatever.
He's headed back towards Mournful Valley?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay.
And here's a question. If he's still a werewolf...
I didn't hear anything after a werewolf.
He's probably asking if
he's still a werewolf. Am I still flying?
As of right now, yes.
Okay, with my true sight, do I see anything worth true sight seeing?
I have worms.
Good lord.
But I already knew that.
That wasn't from the werewolf. That was the existing condition.
I think he has gonorrhea as well.
You do actually see something kind of interesting, Brother Cutter. You see the center of the cloud... Where this lightning and stuff has been illuminating this thunderhead above you, you see a shape starting to emerge. And the lightning strikes again. And you see that where it makes contact with the ground, it has a vaguely humanoid shape. And when that happens, the powers that you had for the remainder of this encounter earlier cease to function. So, Mad Dog, you have taken off at top speed. You're running on all fours, and all of a sudden you're a halfling again. And you tumble face first into the dirt, end over end, you know, several times before you come to a stop. Plenty of grit in your teeth. If you were smoking a stogie before you changed, that stogie is now unfortunately smashed and ruined. Eagle Witness, I believe you are still in the air. So describe to me how that's going to unfold.
You're muted, brother.
As soon as I start to feel myself fall, I cast Feather Fall, and I gently float to the ground with the saddest look ever on my face. But it's also the most grateful look ever.
There you go.
I'm glad you had that prepared. That's awesome.
Yeah, that is fantastic.
Yeah.
Occasion in fact. We will say that Jane and his brother turn and embrace one another, and then only Jane is left behind. And then I will leave Padre and Brother Cutter to describe how their abilities fade.
Oh, well, there's a flash of light, and then all that stuff that I could see before is just gone. It's real simple.
Nothing really happens for the Padre. He'd already used his power.
Okay. Fair enough.
He feels he could only dispel the undead again. But he'll walk up to the Minotaur and say, "My son, will you allow Luz's light to free you of any affliction?"
He kind of cocks his head to the side, curiously looking at you.
Luz is an Eastern god. What power does he have here?
I'll say, Luz's light is all around us, and I'll put out my hand, and I'll wait for him to grasp my hand.
He kind of sniffs at it for a second, kind of blowing air through his nostrils.
Very well. Holy man.
Does he?
Yeah, he'll reach out and place a thick finger into your hand.
And I will cast Remove Curse.
Okay.
Hold on. Actually, I will say, I wrote something up for this. Fear not, my child, for my love shall cast out the demons. Chapter 2, verse 2. And I will.
Nice chapter. Oh, man. Sweet deal.
Perfect, Derek. You can take a point of inspiration, and that's fantastic. Not that you need any more, but for your stockpile. for your apocalypse bunker stash of inspiration.
Yeah. All right, so I've removed curse.
Fantastic.
I'm going to cast Comprehend Language, and then I'm going to tell the Minotaur that if he wants to, he can speak in whatever language he knows best.
Okay. He says, "Thank you for your aid in defeating this evil. I must bury my brothers."
What language does he say that in?
The rest of you hear what you would probably know as giant.
I have no clue what he said then.
I tell him, or I ask him if he knows what's going on up there, and I also tell him that we will help him bury the bodies. And that if he wants any rites done, there is a Durathian holy man and a Luzite holy man.
Yes, the Durathian's ways are akin to the ways of my people, this would be good.
All right. I wave at Eagle Witness, but he's sad, so I say, "Hey, Eagle Witness, hey."
Yes. Yes. Burial rites, of course.
Yeah, great.
He's good. Rises in longingly. Walk over to the Minotaur and say, "Do you know the Kiyohe tribe?"
I have been to the Kiyohe lands, but not for many moons.
I was raised by them, though they are not my tribe, not anymore. Words over the, if you would have it.
This would be good. Yes. We should build a pyre, but I'm afraid that the weather will not cooperate.
And as he says that, the rain kind of slackens and the lightning kind of abates a bit.
Perhaps we must not wait much longer.
Very well.
Bogus Petter is going to cast Produce Flame, which is magical fire, and say, "Don't worry, the rain won't put this out."
Okay, so he sets about to building a funeral pyre, a large one that will facilitate both of the large Minotaur corpses.
Yeah, I'm going to take a note.
Okay, hold on. What did you say, Eagle?
Eagle Witness will help him with that.
Okay. And what did you say, Brother Cutter?
He said he was going to help, but he's actually just going to rest. He's all not feeling so great.
Hi. I have a question.
Yes.
Are these other ones literally dead, or were they like at zero hit points and they still had death saving throws?
No, they are literally dead.
Okay.
They had death saving throws when we showed up, but they failed them.
Actually, Padre, can't you cast Revive?
Well, I can cast Revivify, but I need diamonds, and I think too much time has passed.
Probably.
And I've already used all my third level spell slots.
Then yeah, okay.
Okay.
Do I remember what happened when I was a werewolf?
Yes, you do.
Then I'll go talk to the Minotaur. I'm not sure what came over me, but I'm sorry.
Can you hear me, Mike?
I heard he, and then you froze up.
Okay. Yeah. He is very apprehensive as you approach, and then he says, "What are you doing?"
Not sure what came over me, but sorry.
You turned into a wolf and then you bit me. That's what came over you.
I guess he would be speaking to you in broken common still, but
I'll just leave it at that, and I'm going to go start scalping all the Durathians.
Okay, fair enough. Okay, so you guys build these funeral pyres, and it takes definitely the magical fire to actually get them going, but you do. And you finish the business of a short rest, as well as the scalping that you wish to do, and the looting of the bodies.
Yeah. Detect magic.
Okay. Detecting magic, you do. You notice that her breastplate
she has one. That's
was made for a woman.
Her breastplate has
cut out, Jeremy. In it.
Let me see how many. 2.
Anyone hear Jeremy?
No, I can't.
I can hear Jeremy.
Is it just me?
Honestly, you're breaking up a little bit too.
Say yeah, it. Everybody's kind of being a little laggy at the moment.
Oh, I can actually cast Gentle Repose as a ritual to prevent them from decaying so that you can cast Revivify later.
Well, it's still been past a minute.
Has it been past a minute since they died?
I think so.
Never mind then.
And I don't have any diamonds.
Well, I have unknown generic money that's gems and necklaces and I'm sure I have diamonds. But it doesn't matter, it's been too long.
Those are some mighty sneezes.
Thank you.
Jeremy, welcome back.
Well, it isn't a complete Caldera game unless Jeremy loses his crappy Wi-Fi internet connection. So, thank you all. Good night. No. I apologize about that, everyone. So, the last thing that I heard was Brother Cutter saying something about her breastplate. I'm going to go ahead and kill my camera again.
You said that she had a breastplate that had, and then after a very long wait, we decided that it was a breastplate that had breasts in it.
Well, for the moment, that would be the case. The breastplate appears to be magical. Nothing else scattered across the battlefield does.
Great. I will try and identify the magical aura. No, wait. I'm just going to cast Identify.
Okay. This one reveals itself simply to be a +1 breastplate. It is not quite as shiny and interesting as some of the rest of the things that you guys have found, but there it is.
Is breastplate medium armor?
I think so, yes.
Okay, who wears medium armor in our group?
I don't know.
Not I, said the rogue.
I think it's either. I think it's either light or heavy. Breastplate is, in fact, medium armor.
Dan's wearing medium armor, but he's got fancy armor.
He's not going to want that. Well, I
would lodge an itemization complaint with the DM.
Lodge a what?
an itemization complaint.
What about what?
Medium armor in a group of light and heavy armor parties.
I don't make this shit. This shit custom tailored to you guys.
I think the loot table needs to be rebalanced in the next patch.
I put the breastplate. I take it off the lady and put it in my bag. And now I'm going to cast Augury to find out if it would be dangerous for me to go where I saw that man appear.
Well, it's funny that you should ask that. A voice responds to your spell from the place where you saw that lightning strike. And it says, no, not at all.
No, and it's wheel or woe.
Okay. Wheel.
Great.
And as you spin around to investigate the source of the voice, you see a figure sitting upon the ground. And it looks as though she may have been watching you. Oh, come on. Why is this not showing the thing? Hang on a second.
Because you have to turn your camera on first.
Yeah, if your camera's on, it won't display screen.
Yeah, it wasn't even showing the app that I had the picture open in, because I had it open before I reopened the Hangout. So,
gotcha.
It was not happy. All right. So there's my beautiful face and then her beautiful face.
Yeah, I'm going to book
her. Okay, I'm not going to be mistaking her for an angel.
She knows all the secrets.
She says, there, I mean you no harm. I am but an old woman. And she says, they're smoking her pipe with one
is this a
of her forearms.
As a Durathian? As a Durathian, is this someone I would recognize?
You can roll a religion, and for this, you can have advantage.
Nice. Okay.
Without advantage.
As of right now, she is speaking Durathian.
Oh, good. I understand her.
I got a 15, and you know what? I don't have Durathian listed on my list of languages, but I feel like it's appropriate. So, can I switch one out for Durathian?
You should have had it as a starting language. You should have gotten Common and Durathian as a starting language.
I don't need no advantage to get 26. YOLO, I know what she's up to.
I don't know. It's been giving me problems, so I don't know if it would interfere with it or not. You can try it, though, and we'll see. Okay, I'm sorry. I missed that last part.
I said I don't need advantage to get 26. Then I said YOLO. Then I said I know what she's up to.
I should immediately kick you from my game for using the term YOLO, but everybody gets one. So there's your one. Okay, and what did Eagle get with his religion?
15 for me.
15. Okay, so yes, both of you recognize this figure. This is one of the forms that one of the Durathian gods of the pantheon has been known to take from time to time. This one in particular is referred to as, and pardon me, I'm probably going to butcher this, but Osite Mekon, which translates roughly into the crossroads.
Cool.
She says,
cool.
Once again, in Durathian, she says, she takes a big, long draw on her pipe and exhales it. And as she's exhaling through both her nose and her mouth, she says, you must face the big wolf, but take care. For he is a clever hunter and has laid his traps. The blood of this land already stains his teeth, and he has dug his den deep by the power of his claws. The wolf does not hunt alone, and his pack is growing with each cycle of the moon. The relic of the past that you carry to him now is the last piece that he needs. Make certain that you do not deliver it straight to his hands.
Okay, so Eagle Witness is going to, he's going to kind of, let me see here. He's going to put his hand over his heart, and he's going to say, we heed your wisdom, and we thank you for it. I don't know what else to say to her, though. Is there any wisdom you might impart about stop to this big wolf?
She says, she looks directly at Mad Dog, and she says, there are those among your group, your own pack, who understand the tools that must be used.
So Eagle Witness is going to look at Mad Dog and say, dynamite?
Yeah, and he's getting dynamite out of his bag and holding that up.
She says, no, every time I talk to mortals, it is the same. Such short-sightedness. It is my fault, I suppose.
You're going to take out a second stick of dynamite?
So Eagle Witness is going to say, forgive me, grandmother, I am like a child in front of your majesty.
Yes, yes, this is truth. She says, you, small one, understand that in your adopted form, there are things that cannot harm you. This is the same for the big wolf. It is the same for all wolves of your kind. You must find things that can bypass this ability, this resistance, this armor that you wear. Do you understand now?
Yes.
Good. Good.
So, three sticks?
I just want to be clear. She described it as an honor, not as armor, right?
Armor.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Armor.
Yes. I was searching for words that would better describe what I was talking about in her terminology, and they completely escaped my brain at the moment. So,
no worries.
The Padre will kind of step forward. And he's been kind of quiet because he recognizes that this is not a person of his faith. And but he quietly says, is it Caldwell you speak of?
She nods her head as she takes another puff on her pipe. She nods in affirmation.
Okay.
Good call, Derek.
All right, well, I'm done sketching her, so she can leave now.
She definitely doesn't seem to be in a hurry.
So I'm going to say, Grandmother Osita Makon, please, if you would give us your favor, there are brethren of the Minotaur who must be escorted to the life after. Stay by us while we give our prayer for their safe passage.
You may already consider them to be seated at the great fire.
Ah, thank you, Grandmother.
I actually want to know, though, what's going on over here? So all this storm stuff.
She says this, and she looks up at the clouds, and then she kind of makes an amused kind of noise, and she begins puffing on her pipe, and the storm clouds slowly but surely are absorbed into her pipe and disappear altogether, leaving a starry sky behind.
Yeah, that. What was that?
She says, that was just a parlor trick to get you to come and see me. And she starts to kind of laugh, and she says, and it worked, didn't it?
I gesture at the sky, and Seshat lands on my shoulder, and it's like, well, yeah, you know, you probably told Seshat to come see you, and I always listen to Seshat.
He is a smart bird, though he has a little bit of an attitude.
I nod to myself, yeah. It's kind of a dick sometimes.
Quite the smoking apparatus.
She says, she leans in and she says, you have no idea. So she then kind of stretches all four of her arms out, and you hear kind of a popping and cracking. She says, oh, this body is so old.
Yes, grandmother, we do not mean to keep you here longer than you would desire. Please take your leave whenever you are ready.
Yes, I believe it is time. I have laid the path ahead of you, and I have done the task that I set myself in coming to this realm.
Before she leaves, the Padre will kind of tentatively approach and will start to hand her something and say, please take this with you. And it's a prayer book of Luz.
The evil witness would slap that out of his hands before he gives it to her.
She actually leans over and picks the book up with her two right hands, and she kind of brushes it off with the lower left hand, and she says, now, Eagle Witness, that is no way to treat Padre Estevez's book. He may not be on our path in regards to belief, but he is on a path, and that is all that matters. And she hands the book back to Padre Estevez, and she kind of places a palm upon it as she's kind of handing it back to him. And she says, I appreciate the sentiment, my child.
Yes, of course, grandmother.
But there is no need. Everything that is in this book is, let's just call it, dinner conversation that I have had many times with a good friend.
Yes, of course.
Did you say that to me or to the witness?
Both.
Okay.
Mostly directed at Derek. Okay. At Padre Estevez. She was handing the book back to him.
Okay, that's what I thought. So the Padre will take it back and he'll just kind of bow low. And he won't say anything. He'll just kind of respectfully bow his head.
She says, well, I suppose it is time that I get back to my furs. My body wishes for a rest. And she stands up. And at first, you think it's just a strange kind of trick of perception, maybe perspective playing with you, but she goes from being, you know, humanoid-sized to when she stands up, she's got to be 150 feet high. Just like in the motion of standing up, she just extends into the heavens. She reaches out with her two left hands, and she turns back down towards you and says, good luck. And she kind of throws back a layer of stars, almost like the flap of a teepee opening. And then she steps into the heavens and closes the flat behind her and is gone.
The Padre looks really hard for a glimpse of Luz.
He might just see it.
Okay. Brother Cutter's going to walk over to Eagle Witness and be like, I told you.
Eagle Witness is like, he hears it, but he's not registering it at all. He's just staring intently at the stars where she disappeared. He reaches back and grabs his drum, and he just kind of walks off on his own for a little while, and he's staring at the horizon, and he does so, but he starts to pound on his drum and dance.
Excellent. So, and as the funeral pyres for the deceased Minotaurs are lit, and the embers follow the grandmother spirit into the heavens, the camera will fade up into the sky and then fade to black for the end of this session.
Damn.
Mm. Thank you.
Way cool.
Well, well done, Jeremy.
So, thank you very much. So, we will go ahead and into the broadcast here. But for all of you who might be watching or listening in the future, thank you very much for tuning in, and hopefully before too much longer in the future, we will have our 14th session. And until then, may your dice roll high and your snacks always be within reach.